وَإِن تَعْجَبْ فَعَجَبٌ قَوْلُهُمْ أَإِذَا كُنَّا تُرَابًا أَإِنَّا لَفِي خَلْقٍ جَدِيدٍ أُولَئِكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ وَأُولَئِكَ الْأَغْلَالُ فِي أَعْنَاقِهِمْ وَأُولَئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. أما بعد, أستاذ عبد الرحمن حسن, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Welcome back to the Hot Seat Podcast.
جزاك الله خيرا for having me.
وجزاك الله خيرا. So last time we were on here, we spoke about the background, the history and some of the core beliefs of the group known as the Asha'ara. And you actually quoted a lot of statements from their own books and their own scholars, and really kind of, for lack of a better word, exposed some of their hidden beliefs. We're now going to be talking, as a continuation of that topic, we're going to be talking about what is probably the main point of contention between the two groups, the Salafis or the Atharis and the Asharis. And that is, how do we interpret and understand the names and the attributes of Allah? And as usual, I'm going to give you an introduction. Just like last time, I am going to limit the introduction to a 10-minute limit. And after that, we can get into a discussion, inshallah.
Inshallah.
Go ahead and start.
Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Lahu alhamdu al-hasan wa thana'u al-jameel. Wa ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ahdahu la sharika lah. Yaqulu al-haqqa wa huwa yahdi al-sabeel. Wa ashadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasooluh. صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. I want to start by saying, first of all, our messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he informed us and he told us that this ummah, ummah Muhammad, is going to break up, divide into 73 groups. As the previous nations, the Christians and the Jews, they broke up into any groups. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, افترقت اليهود على 71 فرقة. وافترقت النصارى على 72 فرقة وستفترق هذه الأمة على 73 فرقة كلها في النار إلا واحدة. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said that the Jews, they broke into 71 groups, and the Christians, they broke into 72 groups. And then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, this Ummah are going to break into, I'm going to divide into 73 groups.
Okay.
Then the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, كلها في النار إلا واحدة. All of them are going to be in the hellfire, and all of the 72 groups are going to be in the hellfire إلا واحدة, except one. قيل, the Prophet was then asked by the companions, من هي يا رسول الله? The Sahabas, the fiqh of the companions, wallahi, their knowledge, their deep understanding is that they didn't ask about the 72 groups. They only asked about the saved group. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave them a wasf, a description, and he didn't give them individuals. He didn't name individuals and say this person and this person and this person. He gave a description, because description can be, you know, achieved over time. Yani people can do it from any decade, any century they want, they, okay, as long as they come with these qualities.
Yeah.
And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, man kana ala mithli ma ana alayhi wa ashabi, anyone who is upon that which I and my companions are upon. And then I want to start this discussion by saying, the only group that's saved on what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said is a group who have one quality. I mean, they have this quality, and that quality is they follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they follow the companions.
Mm-hmm.
And since we're going to be talking about Allah's names and attributes, we have to understand that we're not going to take any of this from anyone after the Prophet and his companion. And that's the first people we take it from.
Okay,
that's and fair. And I think that's very important that we agree on that.
Okay, that's fair.
Now what happened was, in the early time of Islam, a group of people, they didn't like this concept of following the Prophet and his companions. And I've spoken about that extensively in the last podcast that we had regarding the Asha'ira. I proved that the Asha'ira do not follow the Qur'an, nor do they follow the Sunnah, nor do they follow the early pious predecessors. I exposed that issue, clarified it, that the Qur'an is not a proof for them. The Sunnah, of course, is not a proof for them. And definitely the companions are not a proof for them. Here I want to mention, what is it that they saw to be a proof?
Mm-hmm.
Where did they go to? If they left the Qur'an, if they left the Sunnah, if they left the Sahabas, yani, where did they go to? They went to a knowledge called ilm al-kalam. That's where they went to. And this knowledge came about after the companions, after Nabiullah Muhammad, after the companions. Now I want to show what the early scholars of Islam said about ilm al-kalam. Al-Imam Malik ibn Anas rahimahullah, he said, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالْبِدَعَ, stay away from innovation. So then they asked him, they said, يَا أَبَا عَبْدِ اللَّهِ يَعْنِي مَالِكِ بْنِ أَنَسِ مَا الْبِدَعُ, what's the bid'ah you're talking about? What is the innovation? He said, أَهْلُ الْبِدَعَ, the people of innovation, who follow innovation, are الَّذِينَ يَتَكَلَّمُونَ فِي أَسْمَاءِ اللَّهِ وَصِفَاتِهِ, they speak about Allah's names and attributes, وَكَلَامِهِ وَعِلْمِي وَقُدْرَتِهِ, and they speak about Allah's speech and Allah's knowledge and His ability, وَلَا يَسْكُتُونَ عَمَّا سَكَتَ عَنْهُ الصَّحَابَ, they are not silent about what the Sahaba chose to be silent about. Mm-hmm. They indulge in its meaning and talk about it when the Sahaba didn't do this radiallahu ta'ala anhum, وَالتَّابِعُونَ لَهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ. So underline that point for me, is very important. Malik ibn Anas is from the A'immatu Sunnah, A'immatu Deen, and he's from one of the four fuqaha that are followed. Az-Zubayr ibn Abdul Wahid, he said, أخبرني علي ibn Muhammad bi Misra. Ali ibn Muhammad told me in Misr, Az-Zubayr ibn Abdul Wahid is saying this. He said, قال حدثنا محمد بن عبد الله بن عبد الحكم كان الشافعي الإمام الشافعي debated a man by the name of Hafs al-Fard. Now Abdullah ibn Abd al-Hakam, he said, كان الشافعي بعد أن ناظر حفصا الفرد يكره الكلام. After he debated with him, Imam al-Shafi'i was in utter disappointment and he hated علم الكلام. وكان يقول الإمام أحمد, الإمام الشافعي, he would say from that day onwards, he would say, والله لأن يفتي العالم فيقال أخطأ العالم خير له من أن يتكلم فيقال زنديق. Imam al-Shafi'i used to say from that day after that discussion, yeah, when he saw what this kind of ideology is, he used to say, for a person to do a mistake and then people just say, oh, he did a mistake, خلاص, it's just a mere mistake, it's better for him than to make a mistake and that mistake leads to heresy, which is علم الكلام according to Imam al-Shafi'i. يعني if you go into علم الكلام and you say something, it's not just a mere claim, a mere mistake, sorry. It's not just a mistake here. It's heresy. Zandaqa. وَمَا شَيْءٌ أَبْغَضُ إِلَيَّ. Shafi'i said, there's nothing more hated to me مِنَ الْكَلَامِ وَأَهْلِي. I hate the people of kalam and the people of ilmul kalam.
I think we did it before, but just translate kalam like roughly.
Wallahi, loosely. Just the truth is, it's Greek philosophy.
Okay.
It is the, yani it's the knowledge that was taken from, what's his name, Aristotle and the likes of these people. Simple as.
Okay.
Shafi'i rahimahullah, he said, حُكْمِي فِي أَهْلِ الْكَلَامِ, my ruling on the people of ilmul kalam is أَنْ يُضْرَبُوا بِالْجَرِيدِ وَالنِّعَانِ, that they get beaten, lashed. Shafi'i saying this, rahimahullah, imam, how did they get beaten? Take branches from the tree, lash these people, take your shoes off and lash them, and they are paraded in the market, وَيُطَافُ بِهِمْ فِي الْعَشَائِرِ وَيُنَادَ عَلَيْهِمْ هَذَا جَزَاءُ مَنْ تَرَكَ الْكِتَابَ وَالسُّنَّةَ وَأَقْبَلَ عَلَى الْكَلَامِ, this is the ruling of the one who turns away from the kitab and the sunnah and turns towards what? Ilm al-kalam. Yunus ibn Abdul A'la, he said, rahimahullah ta'ala, sami'tu al-shafi'iyya, I heard al-imam al-shafi'iyya said, la'an yubtala al-mar'u bikulli ma naha Allahu anhu ma'ada shirk bihi khayru min al-nadari fil kalam. For Allah to test a person in every haram he does, zina, he kills people, and all the sins, Shafi'i saying, unrestricted except shirk.
Mm-hmm.
Put shirk aside. But any other sin, Shafi'i said, for Allah to test you, is better for you than for Allah to test you with ilm al-kalam.
Wow.
And then he said, فَإِنِّي وَاللَّهِ اطَّلَعْتُ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكَلَامِ عَلَى شَيْءٍ ظَنَنْتُهُ قَطْ. I've seen from these people, وَاللَّهِ اطَّلَعْتُ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكَلَامِ, I have seen from these people, the mutakallimin, things مَا ظَنَنْتُهُ قَطْ, I never thought this could be possible. Abu Yusuf, who was a student of Imam Abu Hanifa, he said, مَنْ طَلَبَ الْعِلْمَ بِالْكَلَامِ, anyone who seeks knowledge through ilm al-kalam, تَزَنْدَقَ, heretic. The early salaf didn't use this knowledge, they avoided it. Where did this come from? This is where it started from. There was a man by the name of Ja'ad ibn Dirhamin. Ja'ad ibn Dirhamin, he went and sought knowledge from a man by the name of Aban ibn Sam'an. This Aban ibn Sam'an took it from Talut ukht Labid ibn al-A'sam. Now you have to understand, Labid ibn al-A'sam is the man who made or who did magic on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then this is the chain of this whole name and attributes of Allah discussion starting. It started from Labid ibn al-A'sam. And this is something you have to understand. All the firaq, all the groups, they all started from disbelievers. The Qadariyah, Sosan, يعني, who was a Majusi, يعني, from him they took that concept from. The Shia, they took it from Abdullah ibn Saba al-Yahudi. And the Asha'ira and the Mu'tazila wa mannaha nahwahum, and anyone who took their path, they go back to Labid ibn al-Asam in their concept. ولذلك الإمام البخاري brings in his كتاب خلق أفعال العباد, he says حد قال حدثنا قتيبة عن قتيبة بن سعيد, he says قال حدثنا القاسم بن محمد قال حدثنا عبد الله بن محمد بن حبيب عن أبي حبيب عن أبيه عن جدي قال شهدت, I was present when خالد بن عبد الله القسري, خالد بن عبد الله القسري was a Muslim leader in Wasit and he was a governor there. On a day of يوم أضحى, the day of عيد الأضحى, he said to the people ارجعوا, go all of you go back. فضحوا and slaughter, تقبل الله منكم, may Allah accept it from you. عيد الأضحى, he goes, all of you go and slaughter your animals. فإني مضحي بالجعد بن درهم, I'm going to slaughter الجعد بن درهم. Why? زعم أن الله لم يتخذ إبراهيم خليلا, he has claimed Allah has not taken Ibrahim as his خليل. ولم يكلم موسى تكليما, Allah has not spoken to Musa. تعالى الله علوا كبيرا, Allah is higher from all of that. يقول جعد بن درهم ثم نزل فذبحه, he then came down and he slaughtered him. Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he mentioned a story and I'm going to conclude with that. I think the time's going to finish, so just if I can conclude with this, if yeah, before the time finishes.
Of course, of course.
خلق أفعال العباد, Imam al-Bukhari narrated, he said وحدثني أبو جعفر حدثني قال حدثني يحيى بن أيوب سمعت أبا نعيم البلخي قال كان رجل من أهل مرو صديقا لجهم ثم قطعه وجفاه فقيل له لما جفوته قال جاء منه ما لا يحتمل قرأت يوما آية كذا وكذا. And he said,
you can conclude because you did ask.
So if I can just conclude the story. إذن he said ثم قطعه وجفاه فقيل له لما جفوته فقال جاء منه ما لا يحتمل قرأت يوم آية كذا وكذا نسيها يحيى فقال ما كان أضرف محمدا فاحتملتها ثم قرأ سورة طه فلما قال الرحمن على العرش استوى قال أما والله لو وجدت سبيلا إلى حكها لحككتها من المصحف فاحتملتها ثم قرأ سورة القصص فلما انتهى إلى ذكر موسى قال ما هذا ذكر قصة في موضع فلم يتمها ثم ذكرها هنا فلم يتمها ثم رمى بالمصحف من حجره برجليه فوثبت عليه. Story is going to shock you. يحيى بن أيوب, he said I heard أبا نعيم البلخي saying a man from the people of Maru, he was a friend of جهم بن صفوان. Now جعد بن درهم student is جهم بن صفوان. This is where the belief of the Jahmiyyah started from, by the way. So this man, he was a friend of جهم بن صفوان, they were very close friends. ثم قطعه وجفاه, and he disconnected him. And he stopped. He didn't want to be with him. فَقِيلَ لَهُ, they said to him, لِمَا جَفَوْتَ, why have you cut this man? Why are you no longer his friend? And then he said, what has come from جهم بن صفوان is مَا لَا يُحْتَمَل, something I cannot accept. This man has said things that I cannot tolerate. He said, قَرَأْتُ يَوْمًا, one day I recited آيَةَ كَذَا وَكَذَا, I recited a particular verse. Then he said, I forgot. The Rawi يحيى بن أيوب, he forgot what ayah, what it was. And then when he was reading the ayah, and this man is reading it, جهم بن صفوان is listening.
Okay.
And then when he recited the ayah, he said, مَا كَانَ أَضْرَفَ مُحَمَّدًا, he said, wallahi, who's more smarter than Muhammad? And he's trying to say Muhammad wrote the Qur'an. فَاحْتَمَلْتُهَا, I tolerated it from him. ثُمَّ قَرَأَ سُورَةَ الطَّاهَ, then he recited Surah الطَّاهَ. When he reached the ayah, الرَّحْمَنُ عَلَى الْعَرْشِ اسْتَوَى, he said, أَمَا وَاللَّهِ لَوْ وَجَدْتُ سَبِيلًا إِلَى حَكِّهَا لَحَكَكْتُهَا مِنَ الْمُصْحَفِ. جهم بن صفوان said, if I could find a way where I can rub this verse out of the Mus'haf, I would have done it. This man said, فَاحْتَمَلْتُهَا, I tolerated it from him. ثُمَّ قَرَأَ سُورَةَ الْقَصَصِ, then I recited, ثُمَّ قَرَأَ, then he recited, sorry, سُورَةُ الْقَصَصِ. فَلَمَّا انْتَهَى إِلَى ذِكْرِ مُوسَى, when he reached the story of نبي الله موسى, he said, مَا هَذَا, what is this? What's he say? Speaking to the Qur'an, he said, what is this? ذكر قصة في موضع فلم يتمها, he mentions a story somewhere, he doesn't finish it, then he goes somewhere else and he doesn't finish it, يعني, and then he threw the mushaf on the ground. He said, what is this? Then he said, فوثبت علي, I jumped on him. I became physical with him. Then what you have to understand is that this is a very يعني, corrupt belief, but it goes somewhere, it goes back to something very devilish. Like this man جهم بن صفوان, the ummah unanimously agreed upon his deviation.
Of course, like obviously with those statements, I'm not sure anybody listening would be tolerant of those kind of statements. But I'm struggling to understand something. You said this is where the belief that Jahmiyyah came from. We're talking about the Asha'ira. So what's that got to do with Jahmiyyah bin Safwan?
The great scholars of يعني the Asha'ira, they themselves came to, after their final moments in life, they realized what they were upon, the path that they were treading on, is a path of confusion. Like, let me just give you Fakhruddin al-Razi.
Okay.
In response to your question, Fakhruddin al-Razi, he said, نِهَايَةُ إِقَدَامِ الْعُقُولِ عِقَالُ وَغَايَةُ السَّعِي الْعَالَمِينَ الضَّلَالُ وَأَرْوَاحُنَا فِي وَحْشَةِ مِنْ جُسُومِنَا وَحَاصِلُ دُنْيَا أَذًا وَوَبَالُ وَلَمْ نَسْتَفِدْ مِنْ بَحْثِنَا طُولَ عُمْرِنَا سِوَا أَنْ جَمَعْنَا فِيهِ قِيلَ وَقَالُ. And he's saying, all of our efforts that we exerted, all of the efforts that we did, all of those, Fakhruddin al-Razi, all of that which I did, and what I've exerted, and what I did, and my research, and everything, I'm in a state of confusion. All I've compiled is he said, she said, I'm just confused. Now he says, my belief is, لَقَدْ تَأَمَّلْتُ طُرُقَ الْكَلَامِيَّةِ I've looked at the philosophical arguments, وَالْمَنَاهِجِ الْفَلْسَفِيَّةِ and all the methodological philosophy roots. I've looked at all of them, he said, فَمَا رَأَيْتُهَا تَشْفِي عَلِيلًا وَلَا تُرْوِي غَلِيلًا. It does not quench of the thirst of a person who's in need of knowledge and understanding. ولذلك فخرجين الرازي هي يعني إمام in this field. ذهبي said about him وقد بدت منه في تواليفه بلايا وعظائم وسحر وانحرافات عن السنة والله يعفو عنه فإنه توفي على طريقة حميدة والله يتولى السرائر. ذهبي he said in his works there's corruption, great magical claims, يعني كلام سحري in there, وانحرافات عن السنة يعني deviation from the sunnah. ذهبي said والله يعفو عنه, and Allah will forgive him for it. فإنه توفي, because he died على طريقة حميدة, he died on a good path, and Allah تبارك وتعالى judges the people upon what's in their hearts. ولذلك ابن حجر يسأل لزان الميزان أوصى بوصية تدل على أنه حسن اعتقاده. He gave a wasiyah, which is that wasiyah I just read on you. He gave that wasiyah, the wasiyah I just read on you, he gave it and he perfected his aqeedah. ذهبي ابن حجر يسأل. So that path that جهم صفوان was upon, جعد بن درهم, this a'imma of the sha'ira took it and finally realized this is not working. It doesn't fulfill the goal that we're trying to achieve.
So I'm trying to make a distinction in my mind. Is this attribution of the sha'ira to ilm al-kalam, Greek philosophy as you put it, is this something that the Salafis would say that the Asharis, they took this kind of Greek philosophy into their belief? Or is this something that they themselves say as well? Like, is this a claim that you're making, or is this something that they
Yeah, this is something
themselves?
They admit to. They don't deny it.
Right.
They just try to justify it by calling ilm al-kalam praiseworthy, and there's two types of ilm al-kalam, which is madhmum and mahmood and wahakada. They give those answers. Lakin, we say ilm al-kalam, according to the Salaf, is mamnu'. They didn't allow it. Okay?
Okay.
Especially in issues of aqaid, yani they didn't allow it. And anyone who used ilm al-kalam, yani whoever used it historically, yani didn't use it as a form of evidence. They used it as an instrument to debunk people, yani. But they took it as a form of belief. This was, yani, this is the evidence. The evidence is ilm al-kalam. And okay, the Qur'an and the Sunnah is what? It's no evidence. And I think I've...
Yeah, last time we were here. Okay. Let's get into the, let's see, that's a good foundation. Barakallahu feekum. Let's go into the main topic and see how this foundation, trickles down into this main topic. So when we're talking about the names and attributes of Allah, I'm really talking about the kind of attributes that are relevant here are the things like Allah having hands, Allah having a shin, Allah having legs, a face, all of these kind of things. And obviously the claim here is that these are attributes that we also have as human beings. And therefore there is, there's anthropomorphism happening here, where you are actually likening Allah to his creation. What is the correct belief, according to you, or as you would say, according to Ahlus Sunnah, in terms of these kind of attributes?
So when it comes to nusus sifat, Allah's names and attributes, the evidence that come, the Quran and the Sunnah, the people are three types. There is Ahlul Ta'atil, and I'll come back to that inshallah ta'ala. The second one is Ahlul Tamthil. I'll use that word better. So the first group are called Ahlul Ta'atil, and the second group are called Ahlul Tamthil, and the third group are called Ahlul Sawa'is Sabil. Let me go back to the first one.
Okay.
The first group are called Ahlul Ta'atil. Ahlul Ta'atil are a people who've distorted Allah's names and attributes, and they've taken three ways to distort it. The first one is called Ahlul Takhyil, and that's the Maslakul Falasifa. They believe all of this Jannah, Nar, Allah's characteristics,
right,
all of
right,
them
right,
are
right.
all Takhyil. They're just myths.
Okay.
The second group are called Ahlul Tajheel, and these are the ones who took the maslak of tafweed. They said we don't know the meaning of these characteristics as a form of distortion. And the third group is Ahlul Ta'wil, those who distorted it by giving it an interpretation. I'm going to come to each one of those.
Fine.
Or we're going to come to it in the podcast,
inshallah.
The second group is So we finished Ahlul Ta'atil.
Yeah, that breaks down into three. Some of them say that this is all just fairy tale, magical stuff.
Those
kind of like what they say, metaphorical.
Yeah.
Is that fair to say?
Yeah, but they're more worse than that because they believe these verses have a batini belief. Yani, we're not.
Okay.
That's not the path that we're
not going to talk too much about that.
Yeah, because they're not the issue we're suffering from now.
The second group say, we don't know the meaning of these words. Like when Allah says He has a hand, for example, we don't know what the meaning is, but Allah knows.
So there's two groups that we're going to focus on these two groups.
Yes.
Ahlul Ta'wil and Ahlul Tafweed.
Yes.
Now, Ahlul Ta'wil and Ahlul Tafweed, they're under Ahlul Ta'atil. They are distorters of Allah's names and attributes. But they took two paths. Okay, these two paths that's taken is that Ta'wil or Tafweed. So what does both mean? First of all, they both have something in common and they also differ on something.
Okay, go ahead.
What they both have in common is that the mu'awwil and the mufawwid, both of them agree that the zahir ghayra murad. The zahir is not intended.
Okay, yeah.
The mu'awwil and the mufawwid say, yes, yeah, it's true. When we read ar-Rahmanu ala al-arsh istawa ala wartafa, that's not the murad that's intended, they'd say. The mu'awwil will say, that's not what is intended. The mufawwid will say that's not intended. The difference between the two is the mu'awwil will give it another meaning.
Yeah, which is distortion, like you said. So this is where ta'atil does come into.
I'm going to prove both of them are distortion. How? I'm going to come to it, inshallah, okay. As it unfolds. The second group, which is the mufawwid, what they do is that they then say, we don't know. Yani the zahir is not murad. So they've negated the apparent meaning of the verse. But then they said, with that being said, we don't know what the meaning is. So they don't assert a meaning.
And they say, yeah. Allah knows. Allah knows.
That's what they say.
Yeah. Well,
so the mu'awwil and the mufawwid are like that. Now let's go to the next group, fine, which are ahlu sawa'is sabil, ahlu sunnah. Ahlu tamthil. Ahlu tamthil are those who affirm the characteristics for Allah, but they give it a like. They like it to the creation. Now, this is important that we understand it because it really breaks down the whole discussion properly. Ahlu tamthil, Ishaq ibn Rahawayh, Ishaq ibn Rahuya, however you want to say it, both ways it can be said. Who is a friend of Imam Ahmed? He's a sheikh of Imam al-Bukhari and the Aimat al-Sunnah, Aimat al-Hadith, Dawaween al-Hadith, you find them. Ishaq ibn Rahuya, he clarified what is a tamthil. He said, innama yakun, I'm a tashbih. He said, innama yakun tashbihu law qila yadun ka yadin wa sam'un ka sam'in. Ahlul tamthil, what they did is they took Allah's characteristics and they likened it to the creation, which is what you were talking about, anthropomorphism.
Yeah.
They likened the characteristics of Allah to the creation. And Imam Ishaq al-Rahuya says it means when the person says Allah's hand is like the hand of this hand, or the like of his hearing is the likes of this hearing. Understand?
Okay.
So this is
that important. Connection has to be made for someone to be mushabbihad. Someone to fall into.
Anyone who says otherwise, hatu burhanakum in kuntum sadiqin. Ishaq is an imam both parties agree with. He's min a'immati salaf. Yani Shaykh al-Imam al-Bukhari. He's the Shaykh of al-Imam. He's the one who brought the idea of compiling Sahih al-Bukhari. Who compiled it? Mm-hmm. Who gave the idea? Ishaq ibn Rahuya did. Bukhari got the idea from his teacher, Ishaq ibn Rahuya. Ishaq is the friend of Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah ta'ala. So this is early Imams.
Fine.
Ahlu sawa'is sabil, which we hope to be from them, inshallah ta'ala. What are they like? They believe, Ahlu sawa'is sabil, I believe, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has names and attributes. They're present in the Qur'an. What we do is, these characteristics that Allah has subhanahu wa ta'ala, we affirm it for Him. We affirm it. مِنْ غَيْرِ تَعْطِيلٍ وَلَا تَحْرِيفٍ وَمِنْ غَيْرِ تَكِيفٍ وَلَا تَمْثِيلٍ. I'm going to explain that later, inshallah ta'ala. Imam al-Shafi'i, Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i said, أَصْلُ Qur'an wa sunnah. The asl is the Qur'an and the sunnah. فَإِنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ فَقِيَاسٌ عَلَيْهِمَا. The asl is the Qur'an and sunnah, correct?
Yeah, correct.
If they're not present, what do we do? Qiyas. وإذا اتصل الحديث عن رسول الله وصح الإسناد عنه فهو سنة والإجماع أكثر من الخبر المنفرد والحديث على ظاهره وإذا احتمل المعاني فما أشبه منها ظاهره أولى به. What I mean by that is that we take the Quran and the Sunnah and the ijma. In this chapter of aqeedah, we don't take qiyas. Qiyas is in fiqh. Ahlu Sunnah, what did they do? Ahlu Sawa'is Sabil, what did they do? Ahlu Sawa'is Sabil, they took the Quran and the Sunnah and the unanimous agreement of the three noble generation. Everything I mentioned here, inshallah ta'ala, I'll bring a verse for it, hadith and ijma'.
Fine.
I'm not going to bring you the kalam of the muta'akhirin. Muhammad Abdul Wahhab said this, Ibn Taymiyyah said this, Ibn Qudama said this, Ibn Rajab said this. I'm not going to bring that. I'm saying to you, let's stick to the three noble generation.
Okay.
Ibn Abd al-Barr transmitted a consensus on this issue, ijma. And there's no difference of opinion that the Salaf had on this issue. And I'll state each imam who said it. I'll name it for you, inshallah. Ibn Abd al-Barr, rahimahullah, he said, Ahlus sunnati mujmi'una, the unanimous, this is Ahlus sawa'i sabil, ala iqrari bihadihi sifat, to affirm all these characteristics, al-waridati fil kitab wa sunnah, that are present in the Qur'an and the sunnah. وَلَمْ يُكَيِّفُوا شَيْئًا مِنْهَا, they never placed a how for any of these characteristics. وَأَمَّا الْجَهْمِيَّةِ وَالْمُعْتَزِلَةِ وَالْخَوَارِجِ, those are from 72 groups, right? فَقَالُوا, they said, مَنْ أَقَرَّ بِهَا, anyone who affirms these characteristics, فَهُوَ مُشَبِّهٌ. فَسَمَّاهُمْ مَنْ أَقَرَّ بِهَا مُعَطِّلَةٌ. Ahlul Sunnah, what do they call these people? The Mu'tazila, the Khawarij, and the Jahmiyyah, what do they call them? They call them Mu'attila, Ahlul Ta'atil, distorters, negators of Allah's names and attributes. وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا وَذَلُوا الَّذِينَ يُلْحِدُونَ فِي أَسْمَائِهِ. يعني Allah's names and attributes, they did ilhad of Allah's names and attributes. Last person I'm going to mention for you, and I think his kalab يستحق أن يكتب بماء الذهب, should write this with ink of gold. Because Ibn Abd al-Barr brought the ijma. This great imam brings their names, each one. And I think honestly, after this, and we can stop the discussion here, and the whole podcast can be over. But
I have some more questions for sure.
I wonder what you have on those papers, inshallah. Abu Isa al-Tirmidhi, rahimahullah ta'ala, and his jami'. Imam Tirmidhi has a jami'. All parties agree upon this great imam. And we all agree. Imam al-Tirmidhi, rahimahullah ta'ala, in his jami', he has a kitab called Kitab al-Zakat. And in there he's got a chapter called Babu Fadl al-Sadaqah. Babu Fadl al-Sadaqah. He speaks about the hadith, Inna Allah yaqbalu al-Sadaqah. The hadith where the Prophet said, Allah accepts the sadaqah, وَيَأْخُذُهَا بِيَمِينِهِ, and Allah takes the sadaqah with his right. فَيُرَبِّيهَا لِأَحَدِكُمْ, Allah nurtures that sadaqah for you. Abu Isa al-Tirmidhi comments on that hadith. This hadith has got characteristics of Allah in there. Not just a hand, but the right hand. Look what he says, وَقَدْ قَالَ غَيْرُ وَاحِدٍ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ, more than one imam from the Salaf said, في الحديث, in this hadith, وَمَا يُشْبِهُ هَذَا مِنَ الرِّوَايَةِ, and all of the narrations that are similar to this, يعني all the nusus al-sifat that are similar to this, مِنَ الصِّفَاتِ وَنُزُولِ الرَّبِّ, Allah descending, تبارك وتعالى, كُلَّ لَيْلَةٍ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ الدُّنْيَا, Allah descending the last third of the night, the hadith that I mentioned it. This is what the ulama Ahlul Sunnah said. قَالُوا تَثْبُتُ الرِّوَايَاتُ فِي هَذَا, these narrations are authentic. وَيُؤْمَنُ بِهَا وَلَا يُتَوَهَمُ, we believe in them. وَلَا يُتَوَهَمُ, we don't have speculation doubts regarding it. وَلَا يُقَالُ كَيْفُ, we can't say how. We can't say it. هَكَذَا رُوِيَ عَنْ مَالِكِ وَسُفْيَانِ بْنُ عُيَيْنَةِ وَعَبْدِ اللَّهِ بْنُ مُبَارَكِ أَنَّهُمْ قَالُوا, all of them, they said, قَالُوا فِي هَذِي الْأَحَادِيثِ أَمِرُّوهَا بِلَا كَيْفٍ, go over these verses without any how. وَهَكَذَا قَوْلُ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ مِنْ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ وَالْجَمَعَةِ, and this is the قول of the people of knowledge from Ahlul Sunnah, who took from Malik, who took from Sufyan ibn Uyayna, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, and their likes. What did they say? وَقَدْ ذَكَرَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَ فِي غَيْرِ مَوْضِعٍ مِنْ كِتَابِهِ الْيَدِ, in more than one place Allah mentioned in the Qur'an الْيَدِ.
Okay.
So I want us to count, inshallah ta'ala, the characteristics he mentions. And then later when we go into the discussion, showing you that the way that the Sha'ira categorized the sifat, did Al-Imam Tirmidhi consider that categorization to be any base? Look what he said. He says, وَقَدْ ذَكَرَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَ فِي غَيْرِ مَوْضِعٍ مِنْ كِتَابِ الْيَدَ, Allah affirmed in more than one place, الْيَدَ, وَالسَّمْعَ, Allah hearing, وَالْبَصَرَ, and seeing. These three characteristics we mentioned, are we?
Yeah.
One of the characteristics, الْيَدَ, الشَّاعِرَ will never affirm it. They will say, no, I don't affirm this one. But we hearing and seeing, we affirm those characteristics. Alhamdulillah, he connected three of them together, Tirmidhi.
He didn't make a distinction.
He didn't make a distinction in there. Look what he said. He said, فَتَأَوَّلَتِ الْجَهْمِيَةِ. Point number two, I want you to underline for me here, is that فَتَأَوَّلَتِ الْجَهْمِيَةِ, the Jahmiyyah gave ta'wil. And then ta'wil comes from the Jahmiyyah. Hold that, the point number two.
Okay.
What did they do to it? فَتَأَوَّلَتِ الْجَهْمِيَةُ هَذِهِ الْآيَاتِ. The Jahmiyyah, they did ta'wil of these verses, nusus sifat.
And ta'wil meaning?
They turned it from its apparent meaning.
They gave another meaning to it.
Sahih. فَفَسَّرُوهَا عَلَى غَيْرِ مَا فَسَّرَ أَهْلُ الْعِلْمِ. They gave a tafsir to it, other than the tafsir of the people of the ilm. That's point number three from the kalam of Imam Abu Isa al-Tirmidhi, which is they gave a tafsir to it, a ta'wil to it, other than the tafsir that was given by who? Ahlul ilmi. Then Ahlul ilmi have a tafsir for these nusus. al-yad wa sab' wa al-basar.
Okay.
There's a tafsir according to Ahlul Ilm. Who did he say that were Ahlul Ilm? If you look at the beginning of his statement, he says that Ahlul Ilm is referring to is Malik, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, and he's referring to وَهَكَذَا قَوْلُ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ مِنْ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ. So the Ahlul Ilm here is talking about Ahlul Sunnah.
Okay, no problem.
There's a tafsir jahmiy, and there's a tafsir min Ahlul Sunnah. Underline that point. That's point number three for me. Then he said, what is the tafsir they gave? وَقَالُوا, they said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمْ يَخْلُقَ آدَمَ بِيَدِهِ. Allah did not create Adam with his hand. وَقَالُوا, they said, إِنَّ مَعْنَ الْيَدِهَا هُنَ الْقُوَّةِ. The Jahmiyyah said,
it's the tafsir of the Jahmiyyah.
The tafsir of the Jahmiyyah is that the yad here in this characteristics is what?
Strength or power or whatever.
That's what they said. Then Ash-Sha'irah took that from the Jahmiyyah. When they interpreted and they gave the tafsir of yad to mean quwwah, this is a tafsir jahmiyun. Point that out for me. Then he said something very powerful, which, wallahi, this kalam by itself, as I said to you at the beginning, yastahiqu an yuktaba bima'i dhahab. This statement by itself should be written in ink of gold. And I honestly believe if this was brought to any munsif, an honest person, wallahi, and read it and went over again, would understand that this is what the Salafis are calling to. That's all we're saying. Look what he said, Shah. Al-Imamu Malik, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, and Abdullah ibn Mubarak. These are three imams, right?
Yeah.
Would anybody dispute who they are?
No, not even nobility.
Okay. When it comes to all of these sifat, they said, Amiruha bila kif, and go over it without anyhow. Inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to speak about that in great details later. Then he said, Ahlul Sunnah, the people of knowledge, Ahlul Ilm, wal Jama'a, they follow that path of Malik, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, Abdullah ibn Barak. A group went against all of them. Who are they? Jahmiyyah.
Yeah.
They negated those characters, those narrations. They rejected those narrations.
They interpreted them into...
They rejected for Ankarat hadith riwayat, he said. وَقَالُوا هَذَا تَشْبِيهِ. They said these characteristics are all tashbih. Shahid, this point is very important for me. When these people see Allah saying yad, يعني Allah tabarak wa ta'ala saying these characteristics, what comes to their head straight away is tashbih. They are mushabbiha. They call us mushabbiha. They are the mushabbiha. When they see these characteristics, they see tashbih. So this is exactly what Tirmidhi is saying that Jahmiyyah did. When they saw these nusus, they said, وَقَالُوا هَذَا تَشْبِيهٌ. So then, in order to fight with that tashbih, that just ran to their mind, what did they do? So they did, فَتَأَوَّلَتِ الْجَهْمِيَةُ هَذِي الْآيَاتِ. They interpreted it. They gave an distorted its meaning. فَفَصَّرُوهَا عَلَى غَيْرِ مَا فَسَرَ أَهْلُ الْعِلْمِ. The interpretation they gave is different to the interpretation of the people of knowledge.
Yep.
Shahid, there's two interpretations.
Okay.
After that, and then what was their interpretation? They said the yad here, it means ha huna al-quwwa. The Jahmiyyah are saying this. Then look what he said. He wants to comment on their argument that these nusus, these texts, are tashbih. Yadullahi fawqa aydihim. مَا مَنَعَكَ أَن تَسْجُدَ لِمَا خَلَقْتُ بِيَدَيَّ وَيَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذِي الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ الرَّحْمَنُ عَلَى الْعَرْشِ اسْتَوَى. All of these characteristics, they said tashbih. Tirmidhi wants to debunk them. He said, وَقَالَ إِسْحَاقُ بْنُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ. يعني إسحاق بن راهويه said, إِنَّمَا يَكُونُ التَّشْبِيهُ إِذَا قَالَ يَدٌ كَيَدٍ أَوْ مِثْلُ يَدٍ أَوْ سَمْعٍ كَسَمْعٍ أَوْ مِثْلُ سَمْعٍ. If they say that, the قول I mentioned before,
the same statement you mentioned before,
that I mentioned, this gives us understanding of two groups have been debunked clearly and categorically by who? Al-Imam Tirmidhi, the Mu'awwila, who did ta'wil.
Yeah.
He said the ta'wil is a ta'wil of Jahmiyyah.
Okay.
The first people who did it were the Jahmiyyah. We can discuss that more, inshallah, as we go on. And the second group of people he debunked here are who? The Mufawwila, who don't believe these sifat have any meaning in it. How did he debunk them? He debunked them by saying there is a tafsir of the Jahmiyyah and there's a tafsir of the Ahlul Ilm.
Yeah.
So Ahlul Ilm did tafsir of these nusus.
No problem.
But he's saying, not the tafsir of the Jami. But the Mufawwida, they don't believe these nusus sifat, they don't believe it has any meaning. They just mean it's just words that are written there. Inshallah ta'ala, we can discuss it more.
Okay, so let's go into it in a bit more detail. Uh-huh. First of all, the issue of ta'wil, which is saying that these words that come in the Qur'an, for example, they have a different meaning to the apparent meaning. And we interpret it in a different way, like, for example, the word yad, not meaning hand, but meaning quwa, things like that. Okay. I've actually got statements of the Salaf, and even the companions themselves making ta'wil. They actually take these kind of ayat from the Quran and they interpret it differently. You want to go through them first?
Okay, so the first one you're going to bring is ta'wil.
Ta'wil, yeah, let's go.
Can I, so the listeners can keep up with us, inshallah ta'ala. I don't know what you're going to go into in deeply, but let me just say one thing for the viewers to know. Ta'wil and there's tafweed.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? The ta'wil and the tafweed. Ta'wil means, and the nusus al-sifat, these characteristics and attributes, when those verses that come regarding Allah's names and attributes, they say, yajibu hamluha, it is obligatory to take those verses, ala khilafi al-zahiriha. We have to take it in other than its apparent meaning. When Allah said in the ayah, ma mana'aka an tasjuda lima khalaqtu biyaday, astakbarta am kunta min al-aleen. Iblis, what prevented you to prostrate? What stopped you from prostrating? What is not, yani, why are you refusing to prostrate to the one, yani Adam, who I created with my two hands?
Mm-hmm.
They say, the zahir is not what we should take. What should we do? We should take it other than its zahir. Why? What's your reason? The reason is because the zahir, the apparent meaning, it has in it tashbih.
Yeah. Automatically.
Yeah, just looking at it like that.
You can't strip it out of that.
That's what they're saying.
No problem, yeah.
And then the mu'awwila are saying, now since that's the case, we can't take the zahir, no. Because the zahir has tashbih in it.
Yeah.
So what do? They introduce a meaning. They what? Introduce a meaning from themselves. They say, this is the meaning for it. Allah says in the Qur'an, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُجَادِلُونَ فِي آيَاتِ اللَّهِ بِغَيْرُ سُلْطَانٍ أَتَاهُمْ إِنْ فِي صُدُورِهِمْ إِلَّا كِبْرُ مَا هُمْ بِبَالِغِهِ فَاسْتَعِدْ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّهُ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. I believe they are arguing in the verses of Allah with no proofs and evidence.
So you're saying they literally pluck this meaning out of thin air and they insert it in the Qur'an.
This is a problem that happened and I want you to go back to it, inshallah ta'ala. The word yad, again, they're not saying that the apparent meaning is what is intended. I just said that to you. The mu'awwil, the one who's doing ta'wil,
yeah,
he's saying the zahir has tashbih in it. Sah?
And by zahir, you mean hand.
For example, let's
If we're going to translate yet into English, you mean hand.
We say yet. We keep it, let's keep it. Because translation is another language, and we don't go there. Yet, if you loosely want to translate it as hand, that's up to you. But I'm saying to yet, this is what the ayah use. The yet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when they see that, they see tashbih. So they negate the tashbih that's in their head. How do they give a meaning to it?
Yeah.
I now want to say, these characteristics of Allah, like, مَا مَنَعَكَ أَن تَسْجُدَ لِمَا خَلَقْتُ بِيَدَيْ أَسْتَكْبَرْتَ أَمْ كُنْتَ مِنَ الْعَالِينَ, are four questions for them. General, and then we go to each one in details. I have two responses to them. Ar-Rad, which is ijmali, and Ar-Rad, which is tafsili.
Okay.
When you say this characteristics means this, first of all, I say stop. أَكَانَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمَ يَعْلَمُ, did the Prophet know that the meaning of these characteristics is what you guys have taken?
Did it? Yes, they would say yes.
The Prophet knew it.
Yes.
So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم knew that الرَّحْمَنُ عَلَى الْعَرْشِ اسْتَوَى is istola.
Yeah.
They've got two options. They either can say yes or no. We know the Prophet is the most knowledgeable in the hadith, inna atqaakum wa alamukum billahi ana. The Prophet knew Allah more than anybody. Sah? Good. So the question is did the Prophet know this? Okay, that's good. If the Prophet knew Ar-Rahmanu ala al-arshi istawa man istawla, I ask you the second question. Akana an-nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam dha fasahatin wa bayan? Was the Prophet the most eloquent of people?
Yes.
He was very eloquent in his speech. He could speak, sah? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala chose him to clarify everything. وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ ذِكْرًا لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. So with he was eloquent, right? The third question I have is that هَلْ كَانَ النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ حَرِيصًا عَلَى أُمَّتِي شَفِيقًا مُرِيدًا لَهَا الْخَيْرِ. Was the Prophet concerned for his ummah?
Yeah, he was.
Did he want khair for his ummah?
Of course.
Because Allah said in the Quran, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِتُّمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَءُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. If the Prophet was knowledgeable, مَعَ كَمَالِ الْعِلْمِ بِاللَّهِ, he had great knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَكَمَالِ الْفَصَاحَ, and he was the most eloquent of people, and he was the most sincerest and wanted khair for his ummah, why is it not being brought to us? Him saying الرَّحْمَنُ عَلَى الْعَرْشِ اسْتَوَى means istawla. Give me one place where he said it, alayhi salatu wasalam.
Okay, two responses for that. First response is that it was known at the time that it couldn't have mean yed, could not mean yed literally, upon the zahir. It was known at the time, we have other ayat that tell you that, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. Allah is not like anything. So for example, if you say yet, the companions know that we can't affirm a hand for Allah. It was known at the time. He didn't need to go into it. It's only the innovation that came later.
This is where the problem comes to you then.
Go on.
You said, you used to negate yet. You said, I'm not going to affirm yet for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala because laysa kamithlihi shay. You're saying that yet, if I affirm it, it means I'm going to fall into tashbih. I'm making Allah similar to his creation. Then why did you affirm ya asha'ira? Why have you chosen to affirm seven characteristics of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You chose to affirm these seven and the rest you chose to negate it. Because seven characteristics. The poet, he said, لَهُ الْحَيَاةُ وَالْكَلَامُ وَالْبَصَرُ سَمْعٌ إِرَادَةٌ وَعِلْمٌ وَاقْتَدَرُ. You affirmed life for Allah. You affirmed speech for Allah. You affirmed seeing for Allah. Hearing, irada, ilm, and qudra. These are seven characteristics you affirmed. Ya Sha'ira.
Yeah.
These seven that you affirmed, let's just take two of them. السَّمْعُ وَالْبَصَرُ. Hearing and seeing. Let's not go far.
Okay.
Hearing and seeing. Allah affirmed it for himself. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ وَهُوَ السَّمِعُ الْبَصِيرُ. صح؟
Yeah, yeah.
وَهُوَ السَّمِعُ الْبَصِيرُ. يعني yeah. Allah is one who sees and one who hears.
Okay.
Also in Surah Al-Insan, Allah تبارك وتعالى in the ayah, he said, هَلَ تَعَالَى الْإِنسَانِ حَيْنُ مِنَ الدَّهْرِ لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُورًا إِنَّا خَرَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ أَمْشَاجٍ نَبْتَلِيهِ فَجَعَلْنَاهُ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا. Allah affirmed for the human beings, السَّمْعُ وَالْبَصَرُ. They can see and we can hear.
Okay.
And Allah affirmed it for himself.
No problem.
My question to you is, السَّمْعُ وَالْبَصَرُ is present in the creation. Why hasn't those two characteristics, when you were affirming it, tashbih never came to your mind? Why did yet tashbih come to you for it?
Okay, now we're going into another topic, which is the difference in sifat al-aqliyah and sifat al-khabriyah. The seven that you say that Asha'ala affirm, for example, their answer to that question is that these characteristics are different from yet or saq. These are different because our intellect shows us that Allah has these characteristics.
Can I respond to that then?
Let me just explain the argument first before you do.
Okay.
We know that Allah is a creator and a sustainer of the universe.
Sahih.
For him to be the creator and the sustainer of the universe, he has to have knowledge, power, hearing, seeing, all of these things. But does he have to have a hand, for example? Does he have to have a shin? No, not to create the universe.
Okay.
And to sustain it. That's the argument they put forward.
You affirmed knowledge because Allah is the creator.
Correct.
They're saying that we affirm ilm for Allah.
Yes.
Because we see all of these makhluqat.
And to bring them about, you must have had knowledge.
No. Or first of all, they say ability.
Okay.
They say ability has to be there. The reason why we say Allah's qudra is because wujud hadhi al-makhluqat shows ability.
Yes.
And then they say al-itqan. Al-itqan, the way it's perfected, shows us what? That he has irada.
Mm-hmm.
And he can't have irada unless he has ilm. Wahakada, they give it.
Okay.
What about hikmah? Wisdom. Okay. Characteristics of wisdom, is it not needed as much as knowledge is needed? Why don't you affirm hikmah for him subhanahu wa ta'ala? It's not in your seven characteristics. Another question I have, I'm going to ask inshallah ta'ala, is the dalil of aql. They're saying our evidence is aql, right? Okay, aql shows many other characteristics. I can prove many. The fact that Allah is destroying a group of people shows that he's angry with these people. The fact that he's given bliss and blessing to a group of people means he's pleased with them.
Not necessarily. Of course, it doesn't necessarily mean that. Some of the kuffar in the dunya have bliss.
Jannah.
Okay.
Not the dunya. The fact that Allah is punishing a group of people with the hellfire shows angry with these people. And the fact that he's taking a group of people, and I'm just talking about if we go according to aql. Aql proves all of this. Question I bring it back
But
to
it will never prove hand or shin.
Of course it does.
How does the aql prove hand?
Beautiful. Just because the aql has shown these characteristics, it doesn't mean it negated the rest.
Okay.
You can see, so you have to bring aql for affirmation and negation.
But we have to negate them.
No. Aqlan. Just stick to aql.
Okay.
You're saying, yani, I'm affirming these characteristics because the aql showed it.
Yeah, agreed. Yeah.
I'm flipping the table on you. I'm saying the aql didn't also negate it.
It does. And I'll tell you why.
How?
Laysa kamithlihi shay. So for these characteristics, I don't have
no,
to.
No, I'm aql. Don't bring laysa kamithlihi shay.
No, that's obviously the aql understanding of that ayah in the Qur'an. They don't just reject the Qur'an either, like totally, and they say that none of these ayat, we don't take any of them. They understand the ayat using the aql, right? So we have an ayah that say Allah is not like anybody, not like any of the creation. I have to reject the fact he's got a hand, because aql, I don't really need
because
it.
Because they believe it's tashbih.
But these ones, I have to affirm it, even though the human being has sam'a and basar, I have to affirm it because my intellect shows that Allah needs these things to create the
Not using the aql, you're using laysa kamithli, which is an ayah.
But I'm using my aql of understanding that, yeah, no doubt. I'm using both. They wouldn't reject that, the ayah.
I'm saying to you, if you're, see, this is where it really gets hard for, and pressure gets put on the Asha'ira, which is,
okay, go on.
When you said that these characteristics, ilm, and qudra, and sam'a, and basar, and the seven you affirmed, I affirmed it with aql. My question, simple and easy. It's not complicated. Okay, my ahead. Question is, the aql that affirmed ilm should affirm hikmah. Are we all together? If you say, I affirm ilm for Allah, what about hikmah? Wisdom. That's not in your seven. That's one.
Okay.
Second thing is that the aql never negated it. Let's say, I'm just saying, walau salamna laka jaddala, for the sake of argument, it didn't negate it. That's one answer I want to give you.
Yeah, it didn't negate it. No problem.
So these other, al-ghadab, wal-yad, wal-saq, it didn't negate it.
But there are qara'in that do negate it. That's my point.
Unless, we're going to come to the but aqlan, there's no negate. Okay, another question I have is, just because the aql didn't guide you to these characteristics.
Sorry, I actually want to go back because there is a response to that. The aql does negate hand. Because why do we need a hand? It's to use it to do something. Oh, yeah. Allah doesn't need things. Allah doesn't need a hand.
Yeah, but this is where my argument is. You're comparing Allah to the creation automatically by saying that the reason for Allah's hand is a haja for it.
The word yad does that automatically.
No, it doesn't.
Upon the dhahir, it does. No. If you want to make ta'weel, then it doesn't.
Yeah, but sam' al-basar still say, somebody can say seeing.
Yes.
And the hearing. But Allah has them because He needs them. We're not going to say need. I mean, whatever you say about yad can be said about any of the characteristics you have found.
No, there is a difference.
How, Keith?
First difference is, for Allah, we know that He's the creator and the sustainer of the universe. Mm-hmm. If He's sustaining the universe, then there must be a means for Him to hear us, right? He hears us, He sees us, because that's how He sustained the universe. Yeah. As for the hand, it's got nothing to do with creating or sustaining the universe.
Okay, let me just, for the sake of argument, I do want to, I've three answers I've got. The first reason I wanted to respond to is that your aql has affirmed these characteristics, okay?
Yeah.
The aql that you used for this, the aql has also shown other things, like hikmah, for example, and like many more. Okay. Al-ghadab, wal-mahabba, wa-kada. All of those characteristics, aql, and I can prove it to you.
Okay.
In the same way that you've proven it. I don't know why you don't want to take it. Because you're not able to be consistent. Second reason I want to say is, even for the sake of argument, if I say the aql didn't show what, al-ghadab, wal-yad, wal-saq, it didn't show it. But I didn't negate it either way.
Fine.
And the qa'idah is adamul ilmi laysa ilma bil adami. Just because you don't have knowledge of these other ones, does it mean it's not there? Another thing is that I'm saying to you, I have something more superior than the aql. I have naql, text. I'm saying the text has proven these characteristics, aliyat.
Yeah, but how do you understand that? That's what it comes down to. I'm not saying it.
But if the aql affirmed it. So the naql affirmed it.
It doesn't affirm the meaning. Yeah. It just affirms the wording.
And now, last but not least, my last point, my last question regarding this is that this yad that you negated, what do we do with it now? It's there in front of us. Yeah. What do we do with it?
We make ta'wil, so we
give
another
interpretation. Okay, give us a ta'wil of it.
Okay, for example, power.
Okay. Stop there.
Okay.
Power is, you were running away from, you're still in it.
How?
Power is present in the creation. We've got qudra as well. Also, the qudra, you ran away from, you said yad means qudra. Okay, no problem. Let's, for the sake of argument, qudra is present in the human beings. I have qudra. You have qudra. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has qudra. What's the difference between our qudra? Whatever you say about qudra, I'll say about yad.
And if the response is that our qudra is not the same as Allah's qudra, you can say about yad.
The yad about it.
Fine.
So you haven't, that issue is probably, another thing, don't you see what's happening here right now? You're saying all of those times that the verses of the Qur'an was coming down on the Sahabas and the Prophet, you know, multiple places he said, he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I swear by the Lord, وَالَّذِي لَا إِلَهَ غَيْرُهُ. He says, I swear by the Lord, that my nafs is in His hand. Salawatullahi wa sallam. All of those times he says that. And all of the time the word yad has come in the Qur'an, the apparent meaning was never intended. So then the Qur'an is calling the Sahabas and everybody to tashbih. Look how dangerous this is. Mm-hmm. How many places did the characteristics of Allah Ar-Rahman ala Arshi Istawa come in? Just Ar-Rahman ala Arshi Istawa. 7 times it comes in the Quran. In that way, Ar-Rahman ala Arshi Istawa. The other ways that it comes in, يعني يخافون ربهم من فوقهم أأمنتم من في السماء, all of those places, all of those, the ظاهر was never intended. So we're reading a book, we're reading a Quran that the ظاهر is not intended. Don't you think this can open the door of زندقة? I want 2 things for us to understand, please. 2 things I want us to understand. يعني this ayah is من آيات الصفات. This ayah is min ayati sifat. This ayah is from the ayat of the sifat of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, is different from this is a characteristic of Allah. What do I mean by
what
that?
Do you mean, what do you mean by that?
There are other things that can prove Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's characteristics.
Okay.
And this ayah, scholars might dispute whether it's from the ayat of sifat. They might say, okay, you know what? This is not from the ayat of sifat.
But doesn't that necessitate confusion?
No, it doesn't. It doesn't. An ayah doesn't necessarily have to be, because yani, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala might say, like, يوم يكشف عن ساق ويدعون إلى السجود فلا يستطيعون.
Yeah.
يوم يكشف عن ساق. Okay.
Yeah.
ساق here, and it's not characteristic of Allah. This ayah is not even talking about any. The characteristic of Allah is affirmed with hadiths. We don't affirm it from this ayah. This ayah is not mean ayat al-sifat.
Okay, wait. ساق in English, because we do have an English speaking audience, means shin. Yeah. Upon the ظاهر, upon the apparent. Yeah. You're saying that this ayah does not prove that Allah has a shin.
No.
Does, and but you're saying a hadith does.
This ayah, this here, يَوْمَ يُكْشَفْ عَنْ سَاقٍ, is talking about something totally different. It's got nothing to do with shin.
So that shows that we don't take the ظاهر.
No, it's not. It's not.
You just said the ساق is the ظاهر, is,
no,
is the shin.
The ظاهر for this is different. You know, the, is ظاهر. The ظاهر here is قُرْبَ
How can you have 2 ظاهرs?
Oh, of course you could.
Like, the ساق is, the ظاهر is a shin. Mm. And now you're also saying the ظاهر is also?
Okay, let me give you, said, how can something have 2 ظاهر, right?
Okay.
What does the word dabid mean in the Arabic language?
Like animal, beast, whatever.
Dabin means all of that, right?
Okay.
Even the ants and hasharat is a dabba, right?
Okay. Yeah.
Because Allah says, "Wa min dabbatin illa Allah yirizqu wa ya'lamu mustaqbalaha." Even dabba, the Arabs they say dabba is kulla ma yadibu ala al-ardi min al-haywanat wa al-hasharat. All of them are dabba. If I say to you, "Istawaytu ala dabba,"
which in English means?
Means I rid on top of a dabba.
Yeah.
What are you going to understand it as?
Like a camel or a donkey or something.
Why not ant?
Mm.
So what I mean is that you have to understand.
But that's because that's not fair, is it?
Yeah. No.
Because you put it in a context now.
Yeah, but that's something that in the context.
Course,
the ayah in the context it is.
Okay.
It's understood. No one ever said this ayah is min ayat al-sifat. No one used this ayah. We're proving Allah's shin from hadith, not from this ayah. يَوْمَ يُكْشَفْ عَنْ سَاقٍ وَيُدْعُونَ إِلَى السُّجُودِ فَلَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ. Don't force a delil you brought and then make it. We're saying, well, that's not our delil. This ayah is ظاهر for something else. And Arabs use it. It's معروف عند العرب. Look at Mujarrid al-Tabari, he makes the tafsir of it. يُكْشَفُ عَنْ سَاقٍ means عَنْ قُرُبٍ وَشِدَّةٍ. It's معروف. Arabs use it in that way. And it's مَا يَتَبَادَرُ إِلَى الذِّهْنِ. They know it in that way. This is not mean ayat al-sifat. So what I say is that ayat al-sifat is known. This path of ta'wil is not ليس من منهج السلف. We don't believe it. Also, I have a question.
No, I want to respond to the point that it necessitates confusion.
No, it doesn't. Yeah, it does.
But you're saying that. No, but okay, what about the ayah? وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَ مَكُنْتُمْ? Do you believe Allah is with you everywhere you are?
So Allah, before that, look what he said. He said, يَعْلَمُ مَا يَلِجُ فِي الْأَرْضِ. يَعْلَمُ, knowledge. And the ending of the ayah, Allah says, وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ. وَالسِّيَاقُ مِنَ الْمُقَيِّدَاتِ.
So basir, not alim.
So وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ means ilm. Let me finish. It's between 2 words. يَعْلَمُ مَا يَلِجُ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَاللَّهُ بِمَا يَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ. That's 2. That the ظاهر, the context explains that. And 2, this is ijma. There's no difference of opinion. وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ ijma. That it means, يعني بِعِلْمِهِ. It's ijma. And so, I want to know where's the ijma, that yad means qudra. Rather bring me 1 salaf who said it, let alone ijma.
I interrupted you, you're going to make another point. Do you remember the point was? I interrupted you and said, I want to go back to this.
I can't remember.
You can't? Okay, fine. So, if the point that I'm trying to get at is that if you're saying ta'wil is not allowed, okay. It's not allowed, and you actually called it...
No, I'm saying ta'wil is allowed with conditions.
Okay, what are the conditions now?
4 conditions.
Go ahead.
You see, this is what I'm saying. There's ta'wil sa'iq, ta'wil ghayru sa'iq. When we negate ta'wil, we're talking about the type of ta'wil they do, which is not acceptable. Anyone who wants to do ta'wil, first of all, he has to explain to us احتمال اللفظ للمعنى الذي تأوله في ذلك التركيب. You have to explain to us this word. Remember we said that the ظاهر, the opposite of ظاهر is مؤول.
Mm-hmm.
But the مؤول is a lower percentage of the word. So for example, if I say to you, رأيت أسدا.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Straight away what's coming to your mind?
I saw a lion.
Okay. And then I said to you, رأيت أسدا يخطب.
Mm-hmm.
I saw a lion given.
خطبة.
Then automatically you're a courageous guy, a brave man given a khutbah in the middle of the battlefield. Something like that's going to come to your mind, right? So there, I have to give you the qareena, that what turned this away from it. So I need to give you, first of all, I have to give you the possibility that this word can take this.
In the Arabic language?
Yes.
Okay.
Number two, if the word can take many meanings in the Arabic language, why did you specifically choose this one? You have to give it to us.
Okay.
The loft is mutashabih. I mean, it's a loft which is mushtarak, more like, sorry.
Okay.
The loft, not mutashabih. The loft is mushtarak. It has many meanings. Why did you specify this one? The third condition for a ta'wil which is accepted is iqamatu dalil al-sarif li lafdhi an zahiri. You have to give me an evidence that turned this word from its apparent meaning. An evidence. I need an evidence. Because the asal is what? The zahir is the asal. And the haqiqa is the asal. Why did you leave the asal for? Number four is any contention that is brought, you have to be able to respond to it. Because the one who is upon the zahir and the haqiqa doesn't have to respond to anything. He's upon the
they're
asal.
They're on the asal. Okay.
And those four are the conditions that are set. If you follow those four conditions, we have no problem.
So let's go into, because this is something that is brought forward quite a lot, the ta'wil of the salaf, for example.
Okay.
So the ayah, وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ وَالْمَلَكُ صَفًّا صَفًّا. Ahmed ibn Hanbal said, وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ does not mean وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ, it means وَجَاءَ أَمْرُ رَبِّكَ. So he's actually inserted a word here. He's not just given a ta'wil. He's put a word in here. So that doesn't meet any of your four, that doesn't meet your four conditions.
Beautiful. And Imam Ahmed rahimahullah, that statement that was transmitted from him, which is وَجَاءَ أَمْرُ رَبِّكَ, where he said that rahimahullah ta'ala, first of all, is not authentically transmitted from him. And it's not sahih. It's not sahih that Imam Ahmed rahimahullah said this. And what is the reason for this weakness is Hanbal ibn Ishaq is in the chain. Even though he's the cousin of Ahmed ibn Hanbal, Hanbal ibn Ishaq, lakin, as Imam al-Dhahabi rahimahullah mentioned, that he is one who goes against the other students of Ahmed ibn Hanbal. ولذلك الإمام الذهبي, he said, له مسائل كثيرة, he has many issues عن أحمد ويتفرد ويغرب. There's many issues that he narrates from Ahmed ibn Hanbal, he's very strange in. It's very important.
Okay.
So he comes with غرائب. That's what I... Also, none of the students of Ahmed ibn Hanbal, like Khalal and Marudi and the sons of Ahmed, none of them transmitted this. Also, Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali in his Kitab Fathul Bari, which is a Sharh Sahih al-Bukhari, Ibn Rajab is Mi'aymat al-Madhab. He didn't like it. And Ibn Hamid, he said, رَأَيْتُ بَعْضَ أَصْحَابِنَا عَنْ أَبِي عَبْدِ اللَّهِ فِي الْإِتْيَانِ أَنَّهُ قَالَ تَأْتِي قُدْرَتُهُ, they said that, وَهَذَا عَلَى حَدِّ التَّوَهُمِ مِنْ قَائِلِ وَخَطَأٌ فِي إِضَافَتِهِ إِلَيْهِ. So this is wrong. It's a mistake on their behalf. They transmitted it from this. So we believe this transmission from Ahmed Mahambal is not sahih. If you haven't brought anything from, يعني, it's not sahih, then it's not accepted.
Fine. There's another similar one though, Imam Malik, when he's talking about Allah descending to the lowest heaven, he said this is the amr of Allah, the command of Allah. Where did he insert this word in? This is not the four conditions, like you said, it has to be within the Arabic language. This is another word he's put in the...
Again, it's not authentically transmitted from Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala. Malik, if you go to Sir Alam al-Nubala by Imam al-Dhahabi, if you go to Sir Alam al-Nubala by Imam al-Dhahabi, do you have the sanad for it?
No.
I might be wrong or right, but the viewers can inshallah check it up. That Imam Malik rahimahullah ta'ala, in the chain is a man Salih and Habib. And this Habib, and the scholars, they critiqued him severely. Abdullah ibn Ahmad ibn Hanbalin, he said about him that my father never praised this man. And he's a liar, even the scholars reached it. And his narrations are mawdu', fabricated. And even Nasa'i or Ibn Abi Hatim or someone said that he lies about the thiqat. He puts hadith in the thiqat, the reliable people. So that's also not authentically transmitted from Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala.
Fine. Let's go into the ta'wil that is...
Habib ibn Abi Habib, his name is, I think.
The ta'wil that you would accept, even. So for example, the saq in the ayah in Surat Al-Qalam, Ibn Abbas, for example, said this does not mean shin, this means shidda. So the four conditions you laid out, this fits the four conditions you claim.
I'm going to say, this ayah is not aslan in the discussion. Why are you using this ayah? The ayah is not ayah sifa. It's not min ayati sifat. My discussion with you is this ayah, first of all, we agree, is min ayati sifat. Once we agree is min ayati sifat, then you can say, the Salaf said this about it. وَجَاءَ أَمْرُ رَبِّكَ I will have a discussion with you because I believe وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ وَالْمَلَكُ وَصَفًا Allah is coming. This is ityanullah. It's a sifa min sifati ilahi. Nuzul is a sifa.
Okay, I think we've comprehensively gone over the issue of ta'wil, which is taking a word from the Qur'an and giving it a different meaning to the apparent meaning. I now want to move on to the issue of tafweed, which is when a word comes to the Qur'an and the person says, it has a meaning, it does have a meaning, and I don't give it another meaning either, but they just say, I don't know what the meaning is, Allah knows what the meaning is. That's what I want to go into now. You mentioned before the qawl of Tirmidhi and how you believe it actually negates ta'wil and tafweed. You don't have to say the whole statement again, but which element from that, just to refresh my memory, do you believe negates tafweed, which is the person saying, Allahu A'lam, what the meaning is?
The part that negates it is when he said that the Salaf, rahimahumullah, they gave a tafsir to it. Yani Ahlul Ilm, they gave a tafsir to it.
Yeah.
Other than the tafsir of the Jahmiyyah. Yani the Jahmiyyah's tafsir, Ahlul Ilm gave a tafsir to it.
Okay, I have a statement of Sufyan ibn Uyayna who said, just reciting these verses is a tafsir. Qira'atuha, tafsiruha. Okay, if that's the case, then reciting them, just reciting the word, just saying yet, just the word itself, is the tafsir. And that is the tafsir of Ahlul Sunnah. You don't have to affirm the meaning.
And then after that, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, rahimahullah, he says, لا كيف ولا مثل.
Yeah, no problem.
That's good, okay. First of Sufyan ibn Uyayna, he means, rahimahullah ta'ala, reciting it is its tafsir.
Yes.
يعني, did we not say yad the zahir is what they're trying to negate? Let's slowly go.
Okay, let's go through it slowly.
These people claim, yeah, the mu'awwila and the mufawwida, both parties agree on one thing.
Yeah.
Okay, which is the zahir, what is apparent, the meaning which is apparent is not what's intended.
Fine.
And
yeah,
you agree to that.
Yeah.
And you agree to that now.
Yeah, no problem.
So when you recite it, what comes to your mind? The meaning which is zahir?
No. Something that we have to make a very important distinction. The mufawwida, the people who say that Allah knows the meaning and I don't know the meaning, they affirm the words.
No, I'm not saying what they're saying. I'm going to come to the mufawwida. I'm going to place a ruling on that. I haven't spoken about them yet.
Okay.
I'm saying to you, both parties, before we come to what they both say, when we read the Qur'an,
yeah,
these characteristics, other than the seven they affirm, these characteristics that they say, the zahir, the apparent meaning is not what's intended. صح?
Yes, agreed, they do.
We all agree on that.
Okay, fine.
The zahir is not what is intended.
Yeah.
Because the zahir has in it tashbih, true or false.
Yeah. That's what they say.
What does zahir mean? Zahir means ma yatabadaru ila dhihn, what comes to the mind straight away.
Okay.
They say this is tashbih, we don't want this. صح?
Okay, yeah, that's what they said.
Sufyan ibn Uyayna, he said, don't read it as it is.
Yeah, read it as is.
As what comes to the mind.
You're adding that into a statement.
Not.
That's not fair.
But I just said to you, they agree themselves. I'm not saying it myself. The Asha'ira are saying, well, yes, these verses, when you read it straight away, there's a meaning that pops into the head. But they're negating that meaning.
I don't even want to talk about the mu'awwila because we've done ta'wil.
Both parties agree on this part.
I'm with you.
The mu'awwila and the mufawwila.
But there's tafsir because they agree on it based on different terms. They agree on it based on different
terms. No, the first step they all agree on.
Yeah, they do agree on it. But then what comes out of that is different.
The way they go about dealing with the issue is different. Both parties, the Asha'ira, in both maslak they took, yeah, they agree the zahir of the Qur'an, which we recite today,
yeah,
has the zahir,
yeah,
has a meaning.
Okay. The zahir?
Has a meaning.
Okay.
They're not negating that.
Okay.
They're saying the zahir, it is obligatory to not accept it.
Okay.
We're not going to accept it.
Okay.
So what do we do next? The mu'awwila say something and the mufawwida say something. The mu'awwila says, we're not going to take the zahir. We're going to give another meaning to it. That's the path he took. The mufawwida, they say, the zahir that we're reading, that came to my mind straight away, is tashbih. I can't accept that.
Yep.
So what do? I say, Allahu A'lam. Okay. That's not what's intended.
Okay.
Allahu A'lam. So Sufyan ibn Uyayna.
Yeah, show me in his statement where he said you have to.
I'm going to come to it. Sufyan ibn Uyayna, Shahid, you have to accept that both parties are saying the zahir of the Quran has a meaning.
Both parties are saying the zahir of the Quran has a meaning. Yes, they do.
But both parties, one is saying we're not going to affirm a meaning. The zahir is not where we're going to affirm. Sufyan ibn Uyayna is disagreeing with them by saying, reading the Qur'an, leave it the way, yani leave it at its zahir. What comes to them, I leave it.
Where did he say zahir? We're misunderstanding here.
There's two points that push you away. Number one, the first reason that pushes you to the corner is when he said, la kayfa wa la mithla. Kayf, you only say it to a person who affirmed the meaning. It's a very important point.
The mufawwadha, the people who make tafweed, they also say there is no kayf.
No, I'm not saying...
They do say that, right?
Yeah, we all...
So Sufyan hasn't negated them. He hasn't gone against them.
He has.
He just
because
said, la kayfa.
If he doesn't believe a meaning, kayf is la'ib for him to even say it. If a person doesn't even have... If the person, the salaf, don't just talk, the kalam is with wisdom. They put each word...
But the way you're understanding it is not what...
That's first one. I'm saying my common sense person would say, why did Sufyan say, wala kayfa, there's no how? Brother, you're not even letting me affirm the meaning. How comes from so where does how come from?
But he's already said what you do with the meaning. He said you just read it, and that is the meaning. Tafsir.
But so then it doesn't need to say kayf. Why does he need to just ignore it? He just said, if Sufyan negated the meaning, if he already negated the meaning, he doesn't have to jump to the second one and say, and don't do how. How is a fara of affirming the meaning?
Remember, the Ahlul Tafweed, they don't negate the meaning. They just say, we don't know the meaning. They don't say there is no meaning. That's not fair. They don't say there is no meaning.
They negate the meaning, which is lahir.
Yeah, which is zahir.
That's what we're talking about.
Okay.
Sufyan ibn Uyayna rahimahullah ta'ala, him saying wala kayfa wala mithla is unnecessary if he's negating the meaning. That's my point. That's one.
Okay.
Whether they affirm, they agree with that. It's common. Literally, that's common sense. Point number two. Who knows the salaf better, me or you, or them?
They too, of course.
They know themselves better, right? I already told you what al-Imam Tirmidhi said.
Yeah, but I'm trying to understand where I agree with you. He negates the mu'awwila, the people who make ta'wil.
No, he didn't.
But where did he negate the mufawwadha?
So Tirmidhi brought the name of this great imam that you mentioned, Sufyan ibn Uyayna.
Yeah.
And he brought the statement of who? He brought the statement of al-imam Abdullah al-Mubarak. And he also brought the statement of al-imam Malik. So these are three great imams, right? You just mentioned one of them. Let's bring the other two in there.
Yeah, let's bring them on.
What is it that they said? يعني أمروها كما جاءت and other statements inshallah ta'ala,
which means
I'm going to go to that statement inshallah ta'ala of his in great details. لكن الإمام الترمذي, look what he said رحمه الله تعالى, when he came to the statements of the أئمة السنة, he said يعني he's talking about the جهمية, he said فتأولت الجهمية هذه الصفات, the جهمية came and they interpreted these characteristics in these verses, ففسروها على غير ما فسر أهل العلم, they gave a tafsir to it other than the tafsir of the, I'm asking you a question.
Yeah.
Sufyan ibn Uyayna rahimahullah ta'ala, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, Malik ibn Anas, what was it that they said? A tafsir for these verses. Other than the tafsir of who? The Jahmiyyah.
Okay.
So when the Salaf was saying, يعني أمروها كما جاءت, يعني بلا كيف ولا معنى ولا تفسير, all of these are transmitted from the Salaf Sahihan. They're talking about the tafsir al-Jahmiyyah. There's two tafsir. They're fighting with one that's already there at their time. And they're trying to push it to the side, which is tafsir al-Jahmiyyah. Malik didn't like the tafsir al-Jahmiyyah. Abdullah Mubarak didn't like the tafsir al-Jahmiyyah. Sufyan ibn Uyayna doesn't like the tafsir al-Jahmiyyah. That's why they're saying, read it as it is. Don't go into these meanings that the Jahmiyyah are bringing, saying yad means qudra. Where did you get that from?
You do realize that the Ahlul Tafweed, the people who make tafweed, they use the same statements that you're using. It's just semantics, just how they understand it.
No,
how
it's
you
not.
It. Because they say, amiruha kama ja'at.
Okay, let's look at the word amiruha kama ja'at.
Okay.
First of all, what does the word al-imrar mean? Khalil ibn Ahmed al-Farahidi, Sheikh Sibawahi, he says that the word al-imrar, it means al-ithbat, it's to affirm. Okay, that's what it means. يعني معنى al-imrar is al-ithbat, as Khalil Muhammad al-Farahidi says in Kitab al-Ain. What does ithbat mean? It means affirm.
Is there another meaning for it?
That's the meaning.
Just to pass by. Is that a meaning or not?
No, here it means...
No, not here. Is that a meaning in the Arabic language, just to pass by?
I don't know it like that.
No?
No, I don't know imrar like that, no. Like, it's to affirm something. لغةً, I don't know it like that. The poet even said, يَأْمَنَنَّ قَوِيٌّ نَقْضَ مِرَّتِهِ إِنِّي أَرَى الدَّهْرَ ذَا نَقْضٍ وَإِمْرَارِ. And it means al-ithbat, is to affirm something.
So you're saying the statement is affirm them.
To affirm these words.
Affirm these words. Affirm the words or the meaning. That's where the khilaf comes.
Lie, it sounds, you know, the salaf, these are not babies. When you say affirm the word, everyone's going to affirm the Qur'an. Why? Who is arguing about affirming the word?
You just told me at the start that Jahmid bin Safwan said, if I could remove this from the Qur'an,
but he didn't.
No, but it shows.
But he would like to, but he.
Yeah, but it shows but that. But no, but it still shows. So I don't think you. I think that still shows that there might be people like him who come along later and the Salaf are thinking ahead, no, we affirm the words.
There are Shia'is. But what I'm saying to you is that this was not the problem. Let's not make a rare person doing something or confuse individual.
You're just projecting your belief on their statements.
No, I'm not. Wallahi. I'm saying to you, the word ma'an al-imrar, it means al-ithbat, kama qala qalilin in kitab al-ayn.
Ithbat of the ma'na or the word, the kalima.
Nobody is ever saying, cut out al-Rahman ala al-Arshi wal.
Either Jahmiyyah bin Safwan did.
Okay, but the Jahmiyyah won't.
It doesn't matter, but there might be people who come
the
later.
The Jahmiyyah were distorting the meaning.
So this
was the meaning where the discussion was. I just told you the statement of Imam Abu Isa Tirmidhi, where he said, they didn't say yad is not in the verse. They're not distorting the word. They're distorting the meaning. They're saying yad here means qudra. I'm a quwwa. That's what they're saying. The ma'raka is the meaning here. Yes, you're right. There were times they played with yani words here or there, like wa kallama Allah Musa taklima wa kallama, yani playing around. Who spoke to who? Wa kallama Allah Musa takliman. They did play around with it like that. Lakin, the qadiyya for them was what? Also, Shahid, the second response to Amir Ruha kama ja'at akhi is it makes sense to any individual.
Go ahead.
Bila kayfin. Bila kayfin. Why would you say to me bila kayfin?
Why would they say wala ma'na?
Yeah, wala ma'na, yeah, ma'na al-jahmiyyah. That's what they mean. That's the problem they had at that time. The Jahmiyyah had given a meaning to these words, which were wrong. And it's a Sufyan al-Uyayna's statement you brought, which is where he says, كُلُّ مَا وَصَفَ اللَّهُ بِهِ نَفْسُهُ فِي كِتَابِهِ فَالتَّفْسِيرُ تِلَاوَتُ وَمَقِرَاتُ وَالسُّكُوتُ عَنْهُ, to be silent about it. They bring this.
Yeah.
Okay.
Which, just say it in English so the viewers can kind of keep
he
up.
He said, everything Allah described himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala, his self, or his kitab, the tafsir for it is reciting it.
Just reciting it.
And he said, وَالسُّكُوتُ عَنْهُ, to be silent about
so
it.
So he didn't say affirm the meaning. That's very important.
What do you mean?
He never said the tafsir is affirming the dhahir meaning. He never said that. He said, just recite the word.
But I already told you, the dhahir having a meaning, both parties, we all agree. We're not with this. Ash'ari today will not argue with me that the yad from the dhahir, without you coming, has it got a meaning? He'll say, yes, it does.
And but the statement you literally just said is a bigger proof against you. He just said what we do with these kind of verses is we recite them and we stay silent.
I'm saying yes.
That's what the mufawwid does.
No,
it is.
No, you don't.
You just recite it.
You go further.
You actually said it means the apparent.
Okay,
you affirm the dhahir.
Okay, no, he doesn't.
You've given a tafsir.
No, what's the mufawwid saying? Is he reading it?
He reads it.
No. He doesn't.
Of course he reads it in the Qur'an.
He negates the meaning.
No, he reads it. When he says yad in the Qur'an, Shahid, does he pass by the word or just skip it?
No, Shahid, I'm the one who reads it.
He
and
reads
says,
it.
Imam Sufyan ibn Uyayna is saying the tafsir, the meaning, is by reading it.
Just by reading it.
Okay, they're not just reading it. They're saying this is not the meaning. That's not what's
saying. No, there's two parties.
Kaif.
This, I'll show you. The mufawwid, he reads the word yad and he says, Allahu A'lam. Right?
No, he's not saying that. No, he's not saying that. Shahid, I told you two steps already. I keep bringing you back to these two points. The mufawwid is saying this word does not have this meaning that it seems to be having. Number of step one. Step two, what's the meaning? Allahu A'lam. He's doing those two things. Is that what Sufyan Uyayna is saying here?
He hasn't negated that at all.
Shahid, repeat again. The mufawwid is saying the zahir ghayru murad.
Yeah.
The zahir is not intended here. Okay? Intended?
Before we go there, is he saying that? Or is he saying, Allahu A'lam, it might be the Zahir, but Allah knows best?
Who? The Mufawwid?
The Mufawwid.
No.
He's saying that the Zahir is not intended.
It's not intended. لِاقْتِضَائِهَا التَّشْبِيهِ. They're saying because it necessitates tashbih.
Okay, so I want to give you an example, okay? The Mufawwid is reading the Qur'an, comes across the word yet.
Oh yeah.
He just said, he reads it, correct? We agree that he reads it, he doesn't just skip over it, okay? So far he's in line with Sufyan's statement, Ibn Uyayna, correct? And then he says, Allahu A'lam.
But this is the problem, Shahid. Remember, the Qur'an was read by the Sahabas.
Yeah.
Razin, Aba Razin, he came to the Prophet. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, يَضْحَكُ اللَّهُ. Aba Razin, he said, أَوَ يَضْحَكُ رَبُّنَا. Does Allah laugh? And then the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, yes, he does. And then he said, we'll never give up on a Lord who laughs. Shahid, I'm asking you a question. They came and they interpreted lafiyah to be merciful. Abarazin didn't know what...
That's the Ahlul Ta'wil.
Yeah. They say that Abarazin is shocked with something. He said, does Allah laugh? He knows Allah is merciful. He knows Allah is forgiving. All of those interpretations, that's from your pocket. The Prophet could have sent to this companion. By the way, this hadith is Hassan bin Mujma'i Turuqiyah. Abarazin radiallahu ta'ala, Sheikh Nasir authenticated it. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam here, he didn't say, Abarazin, what did you understand from me? Wallahi, al-zahir ghayru murad. Al-zahir ghayru murad. Bedouin men would come to the Prophet and they would hear the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, I swear by the Lord in which my sword is in his hand. And he didn't say, ya qawm, ya ayyuhal qawm. Al-zahir ghayru murad. The al-zahir is not intended. The mu'awwila and the mufawwida have taken that step with each other to say that the zahir is not intended. I'm saying to you, from Sufyan ibn Uyayna's kalam, the sahabas, or by the way, the sahabas only came and said this words means this. They had to explain it like that when these people start coming. And they started to say, oh, the imams of the sunnah had to start going step further every time these people came. Or else, from the time of Abu Bakr ila yawmina hadha, these issues would not be a discussion. We just left it the way it is. We would have read these verses and everybody knows what it means. And that's how it would have been. When they came and they said, la la la, al-zahir ghayru murad, this is what it means. Salaf said, huh? And the other one came and he said, Allah alam what it means. That's when the Salaf rahimahumullah stepped in and then they started to talk about these issues in great details. Do you understand my point? So the time of Sufyan ibn Uyayna, the suffering was from the Jahmiyyah side. The Mufawwidah were not there. He was pushing these people away. And how was he pushing them away? He was pushing them by telling them, stop giving it these false interpretations that you're giving the verses. Go over the verses the way the Sahabas went over it. With that being said, he's not going to the statement of the Mufawwidah. He's actually saying, when he said bila kayfin, and when they say bila kayfin, that clears to us that there's a meaning already affirmed. They're just saying, which is what I mentioned from Ishaq ibn Rahuya. Ishaq said, you say Allah has a hand, but not kayyadin. Mithla sam'in. Mithla yadin. You can't say that.
Okay. Would you be more inclined to their belief if they brought you an ayah from the Qur'an, which categorically proves their belief?
Of course, I'll take the Qur'an.
So, Ali Imran, ayah number 7. What is it when he talks about the mutashabihat and the muhkam ayat? What is the ayah?
The ayah Allah says, وَالَّذِي أَنزَلَ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ مِنْهُ آيَاتٌ مُحْكَمَاتٌ هُنَّ أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ وَأُخَرُ مُتَشَابِهَاتٌ فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ زَيْغٌ فَيَتَّبِعُونَ مَا تَشَابَهَ مِنْهُ ابْتِغَاءَ الْفِتْنَةِ وَابْتِغَاءَ تَأْوِيلِ وَمَا يَعْلَمُ تَأْوِيلَهُ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَالرَّاسِخُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ يَقُولُونَ آمَنَّا بِهِ كُلٌّ مِنْ عِنْدِ رَبِّنَا وَمَا يَذَّكَّرُ إِلَّا أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ.
So this is some of the ayah in the English language.
Allah tabaraka ta'ala, he divides the Quran into two. There's ayat which are muhkamat and there are ayat which are mutashabihat.
Meaning?
Ambiguous verses.
The muhkamat, like let's break it down for people.
The muhkamat are verses which are clear cut.
Okay.
And the mutashabihat are verses which are very ambiguous. Allah then says, فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ زَيْغٌ, those who have deviation in the heart, فَيَتَّبِعُونَ, they follow, مَا تَشَابَهَ مِنْهُ بَتِغَاءَ الْفِتْنَةِ, they follow the verses which are ambiguous, looking for fitna and looking for mischief. وَبَتِغَاءَ تَأْوِيلِهِ, and looking for its ta'wil. وَمَا يَعْلَمُ تَأْوِيلَهُ إِلَّا اللَّهُ, and no one knows the interpretation of it. No one knows the ta'wil of it except Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. وَالرَّاسِخُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ, and the people of knowledge, يَقُولُونَ, they say, آمَنَّا بِهِ كُلُّ مِنْ عِنْدِ رَبِّنَا, we believe all of this is from our Lord. وَمَا يَذَّكَّرُ إِلَّا أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ.
The argument they put forward is when Allah says, وَمَا يَعْلَمُ تَأْوِيلَهُ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, they're saying that this proves, and they stop there. They say it's a waqf there, right? They say it's a waqf, it's a wajib. You have to stop there. That proves that these ayat, which are mutashabihat, because we spent 2 hours discussing what they mean and what they don't mean, etc. They say that this proves that nobody knows their ta'wil, nobody knows their meaning, their interpretation, except Allah. And it's a clear-cut verse. Why aren't you accepting that verse?
So there's three muqaddimat that they put here, and then after that they reached the natija. They put three premise and a conclusion. The first one is, you mentioned, it is obligatory for us to stop at وَمَا يَعْلَمُ تَأْوِيلَهُ إِلَّا اللَّهِ and then وَالرَّاسِقُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ. That first premise, we don't accept it.
Why?
We believe there's two ways of reciting it. وَمَا يَعْلَمُ تَأْوِيلَهُ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَالرَّاسِقُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ. You can look at it in the books of tafasir and the scholars of tajweed and ulama al-qira'at, they speak about it. There's both ways are correct. You can stand and you can carry on if you want to. So that premise is rejected. The second muqaddimah is, these ayat are from the mutashabih الَّذِي لَا يَعْلَمُ مَعْنَهُ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. The second premise is that these verses, these characteristics and attributes of Allah are what? Mutashabih. The response that we flip on them is, what about the 7 that you have affirmed? How did you put an exception on that?
Of course, they make that distinction.
These 7, why did you make them not from the mutashabih? Because ayah is general.
Because the aql affirms them, for example.
I said again, if the aql, if you go back to the aql and I go back to the aql, I say, what about hikmah? The third muqaddimah that they use is that they said, وَمَا يَعْلَمُ تَأْوِيلَهُ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. They actually explain ta'wil here to be the istilahul mutaakhirin. Ta'wil meaning صرف اللفظ عن ظاهره.
Meaning?
Taking the word from its apparent meaning to another meaning. That's what they said.
I mean, that's what we've been discussing for the last 2 hours. That's how we've used the term. Yeah,
but the word ta'wil. Yeah, but ta'wil in that meaning is the istilah al-mutaakhirin, is the usage of the late comers and those who came after. The mutaqaddimin never knew ta'wil to mean that.
What did they use ta'wil for?
Ta'wil meant tafsir for them and bayan.
What's your proof for that?
Ibn Jarir's tafsir is called jam'u bayani al-ilm, jam'u bayani al-Qur'ani wa ta'wilihi, something like that. Yani, so even if you look at the whole book of his, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, he mentions the word ta'wil here. And it's like me saying, when Allah says in the Qur'an, مَتَاعًا لَكُمْ وَلِلسَّيَّارَةِ. Sayyara here means cars. You know? And it's not permissible to take al-istilah, which is mutaakhir, a contemporary yani, usage of something, and then you impose it on the Qur'an and you force the Qur'an to take that meaning. So those three يعني, مقدمات are what we don't accept. First of all, وجوب الوقف على اسم الجلالة, we don't accept that. The second one, claiming that this is من آيات الصفات, the question I say to you is, why are your seven not part of them? آيات متشابهات. Why have you taken those seven out? Whatever reason you've taken those seven out, just to remember, I will make sure I'll take all of the others out. Inshallah ta'ala. Also, by the point, by the way, I believe the whole entire Qur'an, there is no متشابه.
The whole Qur'an.
There's no mutashabih in the Qur'an.
Alif, la, mim is not mutashabih.
Again, we're talking about word. Alif, la, mim is huruf.
So you don't believe a single word in the Qur'an. So what's Allah talking about here?
Alif, la, mim, we know the wisdom for why Allah tabarak wa ta'ala chose it. I'jazul Arab, to make the Arabs feel unable. But no one asks about the meaning of letters. We ask the meaning of words.
So what does Allah mean in this verse when he says there's mutashabih?
What does ABC mean? Exactly. Alif, la, mim, if we don't read it as alam, we read it as alif, la, mim, the letters. And the basic knowledge that you take in Nahu is when he speaks about kalima or a kalam or the types of, he mentions وَحَرْفٌ جَاءَ لِمَعْنًا. Basic book of Ajrumiyyah mentions that. The huruf are two types, huruful ma'ani and huruful mabani. So no one asks about the meaning of huruful mabani. No one ever says to you, what's the meaning of alif, ba, ta, ta, jim, ha,
fine.
Ha.
Yeah, but I'm,
so the Quran, to ask that is incorrect. And it wasn't,
but Allah affirms that there are ayat in the Quran and mutashabih. How can you sit here and say there's no mutashabih in the Quran? You're going against what Allah says directly.
I'm saying to you, there's no word in the Quran which is mutashabih. Then you said to me, alif, la, mim.
Yeah.
And I said to you, a word
okay.
That's considered letters.
So what does Allah mean in the Ali Imran ayah number 7? When he says...
there's mutashabih.
Yeah.
Okay, the mutashabih here is nisbi, subjective. Each person has mutashabih. There might be a verse in the Quran I read and I don't know what it means. So I take that subjective verse to the verse which are muhkam. It might be mutashabih to me, but not necessarily somebody else.
So can the mufawwad say it might be mutashabih to us, but no to problem. Allah it's not?
No. But that's mean you're making it on everybody, the people.
So you're saying within the creation, the yes. Ulama, yeah, there is someone at least always living on this planet that
sahih.
Knows.
Sahih. It's known. Also, by the way, يعني, also,
so the Prophet when he was alive, he knew the meaning of every single word in the Quran.
You know everything.
But Allah still revealed the upon him.
Which one?
The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You were saying there was no mutashabih for him.
Every word in the Quran, not only the Prophet, in this ummah, it's known. If you want to know, you can know every word in the Quran, every word.
So to him, there was no mutashabih.
There's,
it can't be.
Not even just them, even some Muslims. And ulama today yeah. can say there's not a word in the Quran which is mutashabih to me. Of course, like it could be mutashabih to me a particular verse because I don't know it. I can get out of that ambiguity by just finding out and researching. So the mutashabih is nisbi, not mutashabih mutlaq. I'm negating mutashabih mutlaq, an unrestricted type of mutashabih. But there is a type which is yani tashabih which is nisbi.
Okay, one of the interesting things relating to this discussion. It's just like you accept the Qur'an, Sunnah, and ijma' as being proofs in the religion. The other side, they bring ijma'at, they bring consensus for their belief. One of them, for example, is from Imam al-Haramain al-Juwayni. And he mentions that the Sahaba, and he leaves it unrestricted here. Therefore, he means all of them. When it comes to the sifat of Allah, they would leave the meaning to Allah, i.e. they would make tafweed. What do you have to say about this?
First of all, Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni is part of the debate. He's on the side of the party that we're debating against. So you can't use the kalam of the khasm. It's like you can't use the speech of the opponent.
Okay, but...
That's number one. It's okay, like me saying to you, Muhammad ibn Taymiyyah said, would they accept that?
If an ijma...
If Ibn Taymiyyah said ijma...
It's like Ibn Taymiyyah saying ayah in the Qur'an. Would you they accept that? Of course they would.
Yeah, but they wouldn't
ijma accept... Ijma is a proof in the religion.
Yeah, but if the ijma has been transmitted from Ibn Taymiyyah, they won't accept it.
And if the ayah in the Qur'an is transmitted from Juwayni, you're not going to accept the ayah?
But not the ayah, we're talking about ijma.
What's the difference? They're both proofs.
When a group... And ijma, a lot of people claim ijma. You know, Bishr al-Marisi used to claim a lot of ijma. And Abu Uthman al-Darimi refuted him in his risala where he refuted Naqta ala Bishr al-Marisi, al-Anid. And because the Ahmad Muhammad said, "Man idda'a al-ijma' fa huwa kadhibun," anyone who claims ijma' is a liar. You know, Ahmad had to say that. How do you know the people didn't differ on this issue? Well, I mean, Ahmad is not against the concept of ijma'. He, of course, he believes in ijma' and he affirmed many issues, ijma' for it. But he was debunking Bishr al-Marisi, who just came and claimed ijma' on anything. So I would have to say to Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni, honey, this is not accepted from you personally.
Okay.
Because you're on the other side. That's number one. Mm-hmm. And number two, we actually have statements of the Sahabas and the Tabi'in affirming characteristics of Allah. So it will just prove him wrong, the ijma' he mentioned. Fine. Can the ijma' not be broken by one person? One Sahabi. Imagine if that Sahabi is a prominent, well-known Sahabi. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. He said, خَلَقَ اللَّهُ أَرْبَعَةَ أَشْيَاءَ بِيَدِهِ. Allah created four things with his hand. Abdullah ibn Umar is saying this. Radiallahu ta'ala. And he mentioned the four things Allah created with his hand. He said, Adam wal-arsh wal-qalamu. Allah created these, وَجَنَّاتُ عَدْنٍ. These four Allah created it, subhanahu wa ta'ala, with his hand. ثُمَّ قَالَ لِسَائِرِ الْخَلْقِ. And the remaining of the creation, Allah said to them, كُنْ فَكَانَ. Be, and it became. This is a real powerful refutation of Abdullah ibn Umar, which is if you said the hand is quwwa, then that's for everybody. And if you, does that make sense?
So you're saying, for example, the four things that Allah said that he created with his yet.
Yeah.
If you say power, then what about all the other creation of Allah? Why can't you?
Why can't, why didn't have it?
But isn't there an ayah that says, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ بِالْحَقِّ. Allah created the heavens and
everything
the earth
is
with
true.
Truth. Okay, but Allah didn't say everything. He just said this heavens and the earth. Does that mean us? We weren't created bilhaq?
No.
Do you see what I'm saying? How I'm using your argument against you?
Yeah, I'd see. Mashallah, your point, it's a good point, to be honest. It's a very good point. But that doesn't, these four we're saying are uniquely given to it. That ayah just affirms that Allah did create these things with haq. And there's other nusus where we have the Prophet ﷺ, hadith in the Prophet ﷺ, where he said that Allah created the sama' bihaqin wa arad bihaqin, and the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. More things. You see, there's a difference between affirming something for something and restricting something for something. These four are restricted that Allah said, I created them with my hand. Adam, restriction. Arsh, restriction.
Where are you getting Qalam, restriction restrictions. From,
the Prophet ﷺ. So this, you have to understand. So my point here is, Abdullah ibn Umar, radiallahu ta'ala, a noble companion, is saying Allah created these four things with his hand. At that moment, Abdullah ibn Umar, if tafweed was the maslak al-sahih, ta'wil was the maslak al-sahih, يعني, it would not be right for him to leave it unrestricted like that and everybody can understand. He would say, stop, wait. What do you guys understand it? You know, Allah ghayru murad. He would have said that. But he left it at his apparent meaning. So he left it as, that's what we're saying. Okay, Abu Aliyat al-Rayah, he died 93 Hijriya. He's a tabi'i, right? He's a student of Ibn Abbas. He's a student of Ibn Umar. Abu Aliyah, it was mentioned, Hafidh ibn Hajar, Hafidh Dhahabi mentions in his Tadhkirat al-Hufad, Abu Aliyah ibn Abbas used to sit him on a high place. And all Quraysh would sit on the floor. And then Abdullah ibn Abbas, he used to say, هَكَدَ الْعِلْمُ يَزِيدُ الشَّرَفْ الشَّرِيفُ شَرَفًا. And that's what knowledge does. It increases the honor of an honorable person. And Abu Ali, when it came to, قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى إِسْتَوَى عَلَى السَّمَاءِ أَمَا إِسْتَوَى إِلَى السَّمَاءِ, sorry. The ayah, إِسْتَوَى إِلَى السَّمَاءِ. You know what he said? He said, إِرْتَفَعْ. So where's the claim of Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni? And this is Abu Ali, it's a tabi'i. Mujahid ibn Jabrin. Mujahid ibn Jabr, when he came to the word istawa, he said ala. Those two meanings, Bukhari chose it. Bukhari chose it, rahimahullah ta'ala. What about Ikrimah, who is the mawla of Ibn Abbas, who died in 104. When he was, Ikrimah, he said, yadahu mabsutatani, he said, ya'ni al-yadaini. He didn't say qudra. He didn't say Allahu alam bi murad.
Sorry, I'm going to push you to the English a little bit, as much English as you can, just so the viewers can.
So Ikrimah, when he came to the ayah, بَلْ يَدَاهُ مَبُسُوطَتَانِ, he said, يَدَاهُ يَعْنِي الْيَدَيْنِ, it means two hands. يعني. The next one is Abdullah ibn Abi Mulayka, who died in 117 Hijriah. When he was asked about يَدُّ اللَّهِ, أَوَاحِدَةٌ أَوْ اثْنَتَانِ, is it one or two? He said, بَلِ اثْنَتَانِ, it's two. Rabi'at ibn Abi Abdulrahman, this statement, people only think, Imam Malik said this. لكن ربيعة بن عبد أبي عبد الرحمن also said it before him, Imam Malik's teacher. سفيان بن عيينة, he said, كنت عند ربيعة, I was next to ربيعة, and a man asked him, he said to him, الرحمن على العرش استوى, كيف استوى? Same question Malik was asked, his teacher was asked, how did Allah rose above his throne? And then he said, الاستواء غير مجهول, استواء is not مجهول, والكيف غير معقول. This one's the hardest one, غير معقول, it can't be understood with the aql. وَمِنَ اللَّهِ الرِّسَالَةِ, this matter has come from Allah, the message comes from Allah. وَعَلَى الرَّسُولِ الْبَلَاغِ, and upon the Prophet ﷺ is to convey. وَعَلَيْنَا التَّصْدِيقِ, and for us is to what? To believe. Believing in the words never been a debate with anybody.
So when he says غَيْرُ مَجْهُولِ, al-istiwa غَيْرُ مَجْهُولِ, the claim from the other side is that Imam Malik is saying that the word is not unknown to us. The word appears in the Qur'an. Do you get what I'm saying? That's their claim.
But there was never a contention on that issue. I'm just saying that sounds so pathetic, to be honest. No one ever argued that this word, Allah said it or not. يعني إلا شرذمة قليلون. يعني people, the problem here that Imam Malik was Rabi'at ibn Abdurrahman were asked is, how did Allah go above his throne? The question was how. And here he says, الاستواء غير مجهول. The استواء is not مجهول. It's not unknown to us. Shahid pointed, it's not known, unknown to us. And it's known to us, that's what he's saying.
Yeah.
Who preceded him in giving the meaning to it? Mujahid ibn Jabrin. Do you know who ibn Mujahid is? Mujahid is a man, Abdullah ibn Abbas. He said, أردت المصحف على ibn Abbas, ثلاث أردات. I presented the Quran to ibn Abbas three times, from beginning to the ending. أوقفوا عند كل آية. I stop him at every verse. ولذلك سفيان الثوري, what did he say? إذا جاءك تفسير مجاهد فحسبك به. If the tafsir of Mujahid comes to you, then that's enough.
Yeah.
Are you with me?
Yeah.
So here what I say is that Abu Ali again says the same, and he explains the word like that to mean. Malik ibn Anas said the same thing when he was asked about the issue of al-istiwa. He said, when the man asked him, he said, al-kayfu ghayru ma'khulin, wal-istiwa minhu ghayru majhulin, wal-imanu bihi wajibun, wal-su'alu anhu bid'atun. Then he said to him, fa'inni akhafu an takuna dalan wa amara bihi fa'ukhrija. He said, I see you to be a misguided person, leave the masjid. Here I want you to really like, وَالْإِيمَانُ بِهِ وَاجِبٌ, to believe in it is what? It's obligatory. To believe in it is what?
Obligatory.
Obligatory. The wording? يعني who negated the wording?
Yeah.
Here's the meaning.
Okay.
You believe in the meaning. وَالسُّؤَالُ عَنْهُ بِدْعَ, asking about it is not the meaning. It's asking about the kayfiyyah. That's what the man was asking. Asking about the how is, يعني شاهد, how is a far'un ba'da ithbat al-ma'na? How is it comes from what?
It comes only after you affirm the meaning.
Also, Waqi' ibn Jarrah, he said, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, nusallimu hadhihi al-ahadith. Waqi' died 197. Okay? He's a teacher of who? Al-Imam Shafi'i. He's the one who said, shakawtu ila Waqi' bisu' hifdhi farshadani ila tarki al-ma'asi wa qala inna al-ilma nurun wa nuru la ilaha yudan ya'asin. يعني وكيع بن جراح الرؤاسي, he said نسلم هذه الأحاديث كما جاءت, we surrender to these أحاديث as they have come, ولا نقول فيها مثل كذا, we don't say like this, ولا كيف كذا, and how is this, and then he said يعني مثل حديث ابن مسعود, like the حديث ابن مسعود, ويجعل الله السماوات على إصبع, Allah is going to place the سماوات on one finger, وعلى الجبال على إصبع, and you know the mountains Allah is going to place on one finger. So Abu Mahal Juwayni's إجماع here, also the same سفيان بن عيينة رحمه الله تعالى, he says about the characteristics of Allah. The same way Al-Walid ibn Muslim, he said, who died in 195. Also Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah ta'ala, Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Hanbal, who died in 241 Hijriah. He was asked about the statement of a group of people who say about Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's speech that it doesn't have a sound. And then he said, bala, of course. Inna rabbaka takallama bisawtin. Allah speaks with speeches. هذه الأحاديث نرويها كما جاءت. Yes, Allah spoke with this, you know, sound, bisawtin. We narrate these hadith as they have come. The same thing has been narrated from Muhammad Ismail al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala in his kitab Khalq of Ali al-Ibad. Muhammad ibn Isa at-Tirmidhi, I brought his statement rahimahullah ta'ala. Yani a'immatu sunnah wa masabihu al-duja, all of them. Ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala, and when he came to the word as-samad, it's not from the seven that the Sha'ira affirmed, by the way. He gave a meaning to it. He said that the word as-samad means a sayyid. Yani Abdullah ibn Abbas. So when he says Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni, we have to ask ourselves, هَذِهِ أَقْوَالِ يعني, these are Sahaba to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. Abdullah ibn Abbas, is he not a Sahabi?
Yeah, of course.
Is Abdullah ibn Umar not a Sahabi?
Yes.
So Abdullah ibn Abbas, when he would, yani, even Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he came to the word as-samad, he said, أَسَّيِّدُ الَّذِي قَدْ انْتَهَى سُؤْدَدُ.
Meaning?
That the samad is the master that has reached the pinnacle of mastery.
And it's not tafweed, that's the apparent meaning.
He's giving a meaning to it. He's explaining it.
He's giving a meaning. So he's saying it takes tafweed people out.
Of course, yeah, it does. Of course. Abdullah ibn Abbas, the same thing. He said, As-sayyidu alladhi qad kamula fi su'dadi, wa sharifu alladhi qad kamula fi sharafi, wa al-azimu alladhi qad azuma fi azamati, wa al-halimu alladhi qad kamula fi hilmi, wa al-ghaniyu alladhi qad kamula fi ghina, wa al-jabbaru alladhi qad kamula fi jabaruti, wa al-alimu alladhi qad kamula fi ilmi, wa al-hakimu alladhi qad kamula fi hikmati, wa huwa alladhi qad kamula fi anwa'i sharafi wa su'da, wa huwa Allah subhanahu hadhihi sifatuhu la tanbaghi illa lahu. And Ibn Abbas could have said, no, I don't know these are characteristics, we're not allowed to. Allahu a'lam bi muradi. Then this is da'awah. The statement of Abu Ali al-Juwayni is da'awah. We looked at it, we claimed that ijma, we went back, we found that the salaf from the sahabas, from the tabi'een, from the tabi'u tabi'een, all of them explained characteristics of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala.
Okay, I'm not going to bring the next ijma because that's Fakhruddin al-Razi, and you've already said, and you make a very valid point. And I think throughout this whole podcast, I can't remember you even mentioning Ibn Taymiyyah, for example. You're bringing scholars that both sides agree with, like Tirmidhi, Bukhari, the companions, etc. However, we do have an ijma from Ibn Qudama. Okay. Someone you would accept?
I admire him, rahimahullah ta'ala.
Where it says, leaving the meaning to Allah is the aqeedah of our salaf without exception.
Again, I told you, leaving the meaning, the meaning here that they're referring to is the meaning of the Jahmiyyah.
When someone says leaving the meaning unrestrictedly, that suggests that's mufawwidha. That suggests that's tafweed. That I'm leaving the meaning to Allah. I don't know what the meaning is. I'm leaving it to Allah.
I told you the statement of the Salaf before. يعني أمروها كما جاءت. يعني without كيف ولا مثل ولا معنى. يعني when they say ولا معنى, they mean there's no meaning to it. They mean معنى. يعني الجهمية. The meaning of the Jahmiyyah. لأن Ibn Qudam رحمه الله is a kitab كل لمعة الاعتقاد. Look at that book and see what's in there, inshallah. تعالى. The characteristics he affirms. He's got an aqeedah book. And you can see it. And I already bought it last week, his mawqif with the Asha'ira. I brought the statement of Ibn Qudama when it comes to the Asha'ira, and he has nothing to do with the Asha'ira. Min a'immatu sunnah, rahimahullahu ta'ala. Then, when they say there's no meaning, they mean, yani, the ma'na of the who?
The Jahmiyyah.
Jahmiyyah. That's one of the interpretations. There's another interpretation, which is, they mean the ma'na, that the meaning that the mukayyifa, the mushabbiha gave it.
Okay, there's another problem that you're going to run into now, where you say that we affirm the apparent meaning of Allah's characteristics, and we don't interpret it differently. We just say this is what it means. There's an ayah in the Qur'an which talks about Allah forgetting those who forgot Him on the Day of Judgment. Does that mean now we have to say that Allah is one who forgets, Allah is forgetful? This indicates imperfection.
So the response to that is, number one, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, He negated Himself from forgetting. He said, وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيَّا. It's in the Qur'an.
So isn't that a contradiction now? If you're going to take your method
First of all, Allah negated from Himself nisyan. He said, وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ إِشْ وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيَّا. Your Lord is not one who forgets.
Okay.
That's one on response. So then how do we reconcile? We brought two. فَالْيَوْمَ نَنْسَاهُمْ كَمَا نَسُوا لِقَاءَ يَوْمِ مَا بَذَا يَوْمِ وَمَنْ عَرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ وَنَحْشُرْهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى قَالَ رَبِّ لِمَ حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا قَالَ كَذَلِكَ أَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا فَنَسِيتَ وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى. So how do we reconcile between it? It's easy. The word an-nisyan in the Arabic language has two meanings. The word an-nisyan has two meanings. The first one is called tarku amd, which is the person leaves something deliberately.
Okay.
And the second one is tark, which is sahw, forgetfulness. And the Aimatul Lugha mentioned that. If you go to Ibn Athir, rahimahullah, when he went to the Maddah of Nasa, Amanasiya, he mentions it. Ibn Faris, rahimahullah, mentions it, rahimahullah ta'ala. Even Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, when he came to the ayah Surah At-Tawbah, Nasullaha fanasiyahum, he says, Tarakullaha an yuti'uhu. They left off obeying Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and yuti'uhu wa yattabi'u amrahu fatarakahumullahu Allah left them, subhanahu wa ta'ala, min tawfiq wa hidayatihi. Allah left giving them the ability to follow the guidance and the guidance itself and His mercy. Wa qad dallalna fi ma madha anna ma'na an-nisyan anna ma'na an-nisyan at-tarku bi shawahidi. I mean, he explains it in the ayah ma'na min ayatin aw nusiha. Then ma'na an-nisyan in the Arabic language, it means originally, it means tark, is to leave something.
Okay.
Even in the English, even if I said to you, you said to me, "Akhi, did you bring the drink, for example, the water?" And I said to you, "I forgot." Mm. I forgot here means I left it. It means I.
Mm, but that was accidental, right?
But then so there's two meanings it can have. It can be because the ayah that you just read right now,
yeah,
which is وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِ فَإِنَّ لَوْ مَعِشَةً ضَنْكَ وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى قَالَ رَبِّ لِمَ حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا قَالَ كَذَلِكَ أَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا فَنَسِيتَهَا. This nisyan here, it can't be forgetfulness. So why would Allah
accidental
punish?
Accidental forgetfulness.
Yeah, it can't be that this person left the command of Allah out of forgetfulness or they forgot it. It can't mean that then Allah wouldn't punish us. Allah Rabbana la tu'akhidhna inna sina aw akhtana. You see my point?
Hmm.
The reason is because these people deliberately left it.
So in the Arabic language, it takes both of those means and they're both...
Because if you say ta'wil, يعني Allah tabarak wa ta'ala negated it from himself here. Hmm. يعني Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, we have to do ta'wil here. Nasullah fa nasiyam. You say ta'wil is the chapter, only way open.
Yeah.
Because
or tafweed. We say we don't know what it is.
So what about the human beings? Are you going to do the same for it as well? Because I was mentioned both of them.
No, because human beings are imperfect by nature. So we do forget. We
so affirm. I'm saying the same ayah, are you going to do tafweed for the makhluk as well when you say Nasrullah?
No, because it's an ayah that affirms imperfection. And for human beings, we don't have no issue with that. We don't have to make tafweed or ta'wil. We accept it.
You came to the same verse.
Yes.
One part of it, you're going to leave it and you're going to leave it at his zahir and you say tark means... And the next one you're going to do tafweed.
Yeah, because one is for Allah, one is for us. Just like the sam' and the basr is not the same when you come to the surah al-insan and laysa kamithlihi
shay'. So you're choosing when you want to do tafweed and ta'wil.
No, Allah is choosing because one is pertaining to Allah and one is pertaining to creation.
We already proved the concept. By the way, Allah tabaraka ta'ala doesn't sahu and it's not for him. Because that's what he negated in the ayah. وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيًّا. The one he's negating here is sahu, which is tarku sahwin.
Does he negate it for insan? Of course not.
No, but I'm saying to you, on this verse by itself,
yeah,
why did you choose to negate
it? Because we take all the nusus of wahyain together. So Allah negates forgetfulness for himself there. So we say, okay, that can't mean that. But for the human beings, Allah doesn't negate.
So you're affirming for the humans?
Of course, no doubt. So, we've got no problem.
But then you're again in another trouble.
Why?
Because if you affirm it for the human here in this ayah, you're saying Allah is punishing him while he forgot.
Hmm.
While it's a sahu. Do you understand my point?
Yeah.
So I think there's a contradiction here. The point I'm trying to say to you is the best way out of all of this is that this is not called ta'wil. This is called what? Bringing the word back to its original meaning. That's right. What it means. It's haqiqatuhu al-lughawiyyah. It's what it means. And I mentioned to you, immatul lugha mentioned this. Like Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, rahimahullah, Ibn Faris, sahib mu'jam maqayis al-lugha, Ibn Athir, all of them mentioned it.
Okay. You asked me a question earlier. If you say that hand, or sorry, the word yad means quwwah, means like power instead of hand, then human beings still have power.
Yeah.
So you haven't actually taken away from tashbih, you haven't taken away from anthropomorphism, you've just moved from one word to another. I think the response to that would be that power is not an imperfect characteristic. It actually indicates perfection. It's a good characteristic to have. So that's why affirming power for Allah is not a problem for us, even though the human beings have power as well.
Oh.
Whereas a hand indicates a part of a body. And we can't say Allah has a body. Do you agree with that?
The term body, to negate it or to affirm it, either one of them to need evidence. I am not going to negate a characteristics I have no evidence for negating it. And I'm not going to affirm a characteristics I have no knowledge, no evidences for. We believe al-ithbat wa nafi. Affirmation and negation, both of them need evidence.
Okay.
So when you said that yet body, you're falling into what? Tashbih. You're comparing Allah to the creation. Okay. I'm saying to you, I believe Allah has a yet that befits His majesty. I affirm it for Him in a way that that befits His majesty. Just like I believe that the clock has a hand that befits the clock. I have a hand that befits me. And Allah Jalla Jalaluhu wa Azuma Sha'nuhu, the greatest of great. He has a hand that befits His majesty. I don't know. Laysa kamithlihi shay'. I'm between two things. I don't distort the meaning, nor do I give it a how. So these alfaz that you're bringing, fine, like body and this and that, yeah, they are alfaz which are mujmala. They're very ambiguous terms. They're terms that we don't entertain. We say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger didn't use this term. La nafyan wa la ithbatan. And that, by the way, who said to you that the characteristics that we share with the creator is the same as the creator? His characteristics. When we say Allah can hear, it doesn't mean to say Allah's hearing is and our hearing is the same. We're not saying that at all. We're saying that these characteristics that we're affirming for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are characteristics that befit His majesty. Of course, His hearing was there way before our hearing. His hearing is always going to last. His hearing was never given to Him. And all of those are differences that we can just mention now. His hearing is so strong that He can hear everything. We're restricted of how far and how we can hear. His hearing is, of course, same with His seeing, same with His hand, same with His, yani Him being above, same with Him descending. And you don't compare Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the creation.
I just feel like you're falling, based on this shaky principle, you're going to lead into not negating a lot of things which you should be negating.
Is Allah from the unseen?
Yes, He is from the unseen.
Unseen, majalul aqli has no place in it. We spoke about that when we spoke about logic. This is not a majal, it's not open for our aql to wave and swim inside it. You haven't seen Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I haven't seen Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. We haven't spoken to someone who saw Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And thirdly, we don't have someone to compare Allah to. So on those three grounds, nafiyan wa ithbatan, bring an evidence to me. Khalas. If I want to affirm it, I have evidence. If I'm negating it, I'm going to have evidence for it. The word body, I don't affirm it, nor do I negate it. Because I believe nusus sifat is tawqifiyya. It's taken from the Qur'an and the Sunnah.
Okay. Since we're talking about these kind of logical arguments, you mentioned obviously at the start of this episode about the blameworthiness of ilm al-kalam and using philosophy. Don't you think that the reason why you adopt this approach and why you've sat here for the last couple of hours explaining your approach is because you don't fully understand ilm al-kalam?
I've actually studied يعني ilm al-mantiq, and I've studied what the Asha'ira have said, their own works, their own statements. I've looked deeply at it. With that being said, I still don't believe that Asma'ullah wa Sifatihi is affirmed by Aql. I don't believe that. Wujub ma'rifati Asma'illah wa Sifatihi has to be bil-aql. It has to be based on text, not logic. Allah tells us in the Quran, وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا. We are not ones to punish them unless we send a messenger to them. And we don't punish them until they get to know who Allah is, right? Allah also says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَعْبُدُونَ. Then the job of the Prophet is to convey this message of لا إله إلا الله. And within لا إله إلا الله, we believe the three tawheeds, rububiyyah, uluhiyyah, asma wa sifat. So the concept here that I want you to understand is that it was the job of the Prophet to explain people to them who Allah is. That's his job. I'm not going to take my knowledge of Allah from a Greek logian, Aristotle and Plato, and them guys are going to tell me about Allah. How then? And this is how his brain doesn't know that. He's like me, he's a human being like me. So we take it from the Nusus al-Wahiyyin. You know what's really sad, yeah?
Go on.
They say that we take it from the Greek logians, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger, they say la. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. وَسَلَامٌ عَلَى الْمُرْسَلِينَ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Allah says, سُبْحَانَ رَبِّكَ رَبِّ الْعِزَّةِ عَمَّا يَصِفُونَ. Exalted is Allah tabarak wa ta'ala with what they describe him with. وَسَلَامٌ عَلَى الْمُرْسَلِينَ. Allah says, peace be to the messengers. So the rest of the people, the way they explain Allah, the mutakallimin, and the way they speak about Allah, Allah debunks them. And he said, peace be to the way that the messengers, and his safety is in way the messengers, how they describe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Right.
So I'm saying to you, that's what we want. Allah. وَسَلَامٌ عَلَى الْمُرْسَلِينَ. The path that's safe, that's upright and correct, is the path of the messengers and the prophets. Now,
okay. There is one thing that they do, is very common argument. And that is the issue of al-hadith, which is basically the and then obviously it's going to come back to the principle you just set out, but it's basically the concept that, take Allah's speech, for example. They say Allah's speech is not connected to His will. Allah's speech is eternal. He's always speaking. Because if you say it's connected to His will, which is what you affirm, then Allah is not always speaking. Therefore, His speech is not eternal. And you've just said a part of Allah is not eternal. And that takes out the definition of Allah being eternal?
Subhanahu wa ta'ala. First of all, that's again a philosophical argument. Again, we have nusus, clear-cut evidences. وَإِنْ أَحَدُ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اسْتُجَارَكَ فَأَجِرُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ أَبْلِغُهُ مَأْمَنَهُ. We have Qur'an that clearly tells us the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have that Allah tabar, وَلَمَّا جَاءَ مُوسَى لِمِقَاتِنَا وَكَلَّمَهُ رَبُّهُ. When Allah spoke to him, Musa alayhi salam, and then the characters, Allah chose to speak to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see, Allah chose to speak to Musa alayhi salam. وَكَلَّمَهُ رَبُّهُ. The ayah clearly tells us, وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. Allah spoke to Musa alayhi salam. Now the point here is that this mas'ala, which they call دَلِيلُ الْأَعْرَاضِ وَحُدُوثِ الْأَجْسَامِ, is a mas'ala khatira jiddan. It's a mas'ala tawila. It's a long discussion that needs a long bath. Maybe I think we should make another episode in just this one by itself to talk about it and to go into deep detail. These people originally, as I said before, they were trying to prove Allah's existence. That's where the whole issue came to them. So in order to prove Allah tabarak wa ta'ala exists, they have to prove Allah tabarak wa ta'ala always was there. He's qadeem.
Yeah.
So, and that Allah tabarak,
which you believe he obviously was, right? He
Allah
was
always existed,
there.
We believe yeah. that. But where we prove it from is the Qur'an and the Sunnah.
Okay.
رَضِيَ مَنْ رَضِيَ وَأَبَى مَنْ أَبَى. And the Qur'an is a proof for us. These people, they rationally wanted to convince others. They took a path which was very
confusing. Are his attributes eternal though?
Of course, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is eternal.
So, but his speech then, how can you say...
We say Allah's speech is connected to two things.
Okay.
We believe this, some of the sifat are sifat datiyah, and some are sifat fi'liyah, and some are sifat datiyatun fi'liyah.
Okay, where did you get this categorization from? I thought you're not using the aql.
No, we're not using that. We're saying that, when we looked at, it's called sabr, it's called tatabbu' al-istiqra. When we follow the Qur'an and the Sunnah, we find categorization. The Qur'an categorizes the thing. Just the same way we found the Arab speech is kali ismun wa fi'lun wa harfun. The same way we found the hadith of the Prophet, sahihun, hasanun, da'ifun. The same, tatabbu' al-istiqra, everyone follows it. Even the Asha'ira follow this concept as well. They categorize the tawhid into three as well. But the problem is that tawhidul uluhiyah is not part of that categorization. So when they scream at us and say, why are you guys doing taqseem? The real problem they have with us is they don't believe in uluhiyah. So they're saying, and where you get this taqseem at from? But the taqseem is mawjood. Shahrastani has a taqseem, and they all have it. They mention the taqseemat of the tawhid in the three as well. It's funny. But I won't go into that one. Maybe another time would be nice. So Allah's characteristics are three types. There's characteristics which are connected to Allah's dhat subhanahu wa ta'ala, like as-sam' wal-basar and all of those. And there's sifat which are sifat fi'liyah. They're connected to Allah's will. He does it when he wants and he doesn't do what he wants. The characteristics are always there. If walillahi al-mathalu al-a'la, Allah has a high example. I can write right now, sah?
Yeah, you can, but you're not.
Just because I'm not writing doesn't mean I'm not a writer.
You have the ability to write.
That's all it is. The third type is called sifat dhatiyatun fi'liyatun. When I say I read this ilm al-kalam, they think Salafis don't know these things. The third type is called sifatun dhatiyatun fi'liyah, meaning it's connected to Allah's that, and it is also connected to Allah's action, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there is qadimun nawa, hadithatul ahad, they call it. The characteristics, is, as I mentioned to you, is present in Allah. Allah speaks, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then each person he speaks to, when he spoke to Musa, that is hadith. The original characteristics is present in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala.
So give an example of something that Allah does, fi'liya, but it's not part of his that.
Fi'liya.
Yeah.
Like a nuzul.
Okay.
Descending.
I see. Okay.
Or it's characteristic that happens when Allah, thuluthul layl al-akhir, when Allah descends in a way that befits his majesty.
Right, yeah. Okay.
So sifat dhatiyatu fi'liya is only sifatul kalam. That's the only one that's categorized, that goes into those two types of parts. It's connected. Asha'ira, when they affirm it, they only affirm it from the angle of the sifat dhatiyah. They don't affirm it from sifat fi'liya. Hence why they believe it's sifatun qa'imatun bidhati Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. They call it sifat which is in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. It doesn't come out of him.
Okay. I'm going to move on to some closing questions, and I'm going to give you an opportunity to summarize what we've discussed so far. Okay, the first question I have, which is a very common claim, is that this issue of affirming the apparent meaning was not known until Ibn Taymiyyah came along. And like I said, you actually haven't mentioned his name throughout the podcast, but he was the first one to come up with the aqeedah of affirming the ma'na, affirming the meaning. It was not known before him. What do you say about that?
That's not true, because I've mentioned some statements of the Salaf, rahimahumullah ta'ala, affirming characteristics for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And yani, I mentioned Abu Aliya, I mentioned Mujahid ibn Jabrin, I mentioned Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, I mentioned Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Abbas, I mentioned all of them.
Fine.
You see, just because, look, just because there's a word that two entities, I mean, two parties share it. I don't want to use the word entity or party, but there is Allah who has these characteristics and we have this characteristic. The scholars, they say, al-ishtiraku fil asma'i wa-sifat, sharing the name and the attributes, la yastalzimu tamathul al-musammayat wal-mawsufat. It doesn't mean we're the same. يعني, like I mentioned before, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala in the ayah, he said, هَلَ تَعَالَى الْإِنسَانِ حَيْنُ مِنَ الدَّهْرِ لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُورًا إِنَّا خَرَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ أَمْشَاجٍ نَبْتَلِيهِ فَجَعَلْنَاهُ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا. سمع والبصر ليس كمثل شيء وهو السميع البصير. We have the same name. And the description is this, يعني, Allah is a name, we have the name, we share it. That doesn't mean is the kayfiyah and how. Just the same way, in Jannah, Allah mentions subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, مَثَلُ الْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي وُعِدَ الْمُتَّقُونَ فِيهَا أَنْهَارٌ مِّن مَّاءٍ غَيْرِ آسِنٍ وَأَنْهَارٌ مِّن لَّبَنٍ لَّمْ يَتَغَيَّرْ طَعْمُهُ وَأَنْهَارٌ مِّن خَمْرٍ لَّذَّةٍ لِّلشَّارِبِينَ وَأَنْهَارٌ مِّن عَسَلٍ مُّصَفًّى وَلَهُمْ فِيهَا مِن كُلِّ الثَّمَرَاتِ وَمَغْفِرَةٌ مِّن رَّبِّهِمْ كَمَنْ هُوَ خَالِدٌ فِي النَّارِ وَسُقُوا مَاءً حَمِيمًا فَقَطَّعَ مَعَهُمْ. Allah mentions that in Jannah there's going to be a river of milk. Do you think the milk in Jannah is the same as the milk here? The khamar that's in Jannah, is it the same as this khamar? It's only the name. The Sahabas, they used to consider this not to be exactly the same. So, يعني, we believe that these characteristics are present for Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. These names, He has them. Even if the name is shared by the humans, it doesn't necessarily mean that they're the same.
Okay, the next question, again, it goes back to the issue of logic and using logic. And this is not necessarily restricted to Ash'ara. It's a lot of the brothers giving da'wah, they tend to use these kind of terms. Is it permissible for us to say things like Allah is the prime mover or Allah is the first cause?
These istilahat, you see that they use these brothers, which are very mujmala, they're very ambiguous. But that is one of the blessing of يعني, the salaf when you read their works is that they restrict themselves to what the Qur'an and the Sunnah mention. A lot of these brothers, they use kalam, which they took from يعني, Asha'ira. And because of that, they adopted a very corrupt يعني, tariqah when it comes to يعني, they want to affirm Allah's existence, and they took the concept of Dalil al-Arad wa Huduth al-Ajsam by the Asha'ira, Muhammad al-Ghazali and their likes, and they used that to prove Allah tabaraka ta'ala's existence. And by default, they fell into what? They fell into يعني, nafyu sifat. They have to negate the characteristics, the way they kept it going. They have to negate Allah's names and attributes. So it's a problem. And the reason for that is because they haven't read the books of the Salaf, rahimahumullah, usul al-sunnah, books like that. And what was the mawqif of the Salaf regarding these issues? Well, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, rahimahullah ta'ala, of course, he has a yadun bayda, a very good discussion in these issues. A person should read these works. But some people may not understand his works. Ibn Taymiyyah, Risalat al-Madani is very good. His Tadmuriyyah is very, very good. His Hamawiyyah is also good. Wasatiyyah is very basic, like it's good as well. Ibn al-Qayyim's kitab, which I read before I came here, especially on the issues of ta'wil, is his kitab Mukhtasar Sawa'iq al-Mursala. Amazing, يعني, حقيقةً amazing for a Salafi to read. Like, if you read Ibn al-Qayyim's يعني, Sawa'iq al-Mursala, even his Nuniyyah, if you could read it, wallahi, you be gobsmacked how Ibn al-Qayyim يعني, debunks them. You know the four questions I asked you at the beginning?
Yeah.
That I said to you, if Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, does he not know then Allah better than all of us? And you said yes.
Prophet know Allah better than all of us.
Yeah, sorry, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, does he not know Allah more than us? Yeah, you said yes. And then I said to you, okay, does the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have more eloquence than us? Is he not more eloquent than us? And you said yes, he is. And then I asked you, is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more concerned about the ummah than we are? And you said yes. Those three questions Ibn al-Qayyim asked it, rahimahullah ta'ala. It was a question that he put to the people. He put those questions. He said in his poetry, فَسَلِ الْمُعَطِّلَ عَنْ ثَلَاثِ مَسَائِلٍ تَقْضِي عَلَى التَّعَطِيلِ بِالْبُطْلَانِ مَاذَا تَقُولُ أَكَانَ يَعْرِفُ رَبَّهُ هَذَا الرَّسُولِ حَقِيقَةَ الْعِرْفَانِ أَمْ لَا وَهَلْ كَانَتْ نَصِيحَتُهُ لَنَا كُلُّ النَّصِيحَةِ لَيْسَ بِالْخَوَّانِ أَمْ لَا وَهَلْ حَازَ الْبَلَاغَةَ كُلَّهَا فَاللَّفْظُ وَالْمَعْنَى لَهُ طَوْعَانِ فَإِذَا انْتَهَتْ هَذِهِ الثَّلَاثَةُ فيه كاملة مبرأة من النقصان فلأي شيء عاش فينا كاتما للنفي والتعطيل في الأزمان بل مفصحا بالضد منه حقيقة الإفصاح موضحة بكل بيان ولأي شيء لم يصرح بالذي صرحتموه في ربنا الرحمن ألعجزي عن ذاك أم تقصيره في النصح أم لخفاء هذا ألعجزي عن he said ألعجزي عن ذاك أم تقصيره في النصح أم لخفاء هذا الشان حاشه بل ذا وصفكم يا أمة التعطيل للمبعوث بالقرآن. He said ask these three questions فسأل المعطلة عن ثلاث مسائل. Ask the mu'attila these three questions. تقضي على التعطيل بالبطلان. You would destroy them from their roots. The Prophet was the most knowledgeable man. There's no one more knowledgeable than him, alayhi salatu wasalam. He knew Allah tabarak wa ta'ala more than us. Inna atqaakum wa alamukum billahi ana. And nowhere you're going to find the Prophet saying istawa imin istawlayo. Al-yad means qudra'yo. يعني أو قوة or him saying ويبقى وجه ربك means ويبقى ذات ربي. يعني none of that. Also, he was more fasih than any one of us. Allah sent him for that reason. He was more eloquent than all of us. وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِن رَّسُولٍ إِلَّا بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِهِ لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ فَيُضِلُّ اللَّهُ مَن يَشَاءُ وَيَهْدِي مَن يَشَاءُ وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. And he's eloquent. Allah sent him to clarify, لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ. And also he was concerned for this ummah. لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِتُّمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَءُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. With all of that, he didn't say this. So Ibn al-Qayyim's Kitab Nuniyah, you find, يعني, you know what's really shocking? الحياة والكلام والبصر والسمع والإرادة والعلم والقدر والقدرة. All of those seven that they affirm, Allah being above his throne is more mentioned in the Quran. Those seven, صفتي علو is higher than it. Ibn al-Qayyim said, يا قومنا والله إن لقولنا ألف تدل عليه بل ألفاني عقلا ونقلا مع صريح الفطرة الأولى وذوق حلاوة القرآن كل يدل بأنه سبحانه فوق السماء مبين الأكوان. We have 1,000 evidences from the Quran,
for Allah being above his throne,
from the Quran, from the Sunnah, from the يعني from the fitra, from the different,
because of the words anzala meaning sent down and things like that.
Many. مع ذلك, they've affirmed these seven, which alhamdulillah they should affirm. And inshallah I'm going to discuss more. Even these seven, do they literally affirm it the way that we affirm it? And that's another discussion. One of the people, one brother who mashallah alhamdulillah Allah guided him and left his belief, one of the questions I asked him that really put him to, pinned him to the wall, was that I asked him, what's the dabit sahih lima yasih ta'wilu min as-sifat wa ma la yasih? Give me a clear cut dabit, a narrowed down answer of which characteristics can you affirm for Allah and which characteristics you can't affirm. Just give me a conclusion. You said these seven, lahu al-hayat wal-kalam wal-basar, sam'un iradatun wa-ilmun wa-qtadar. These seven, okay, jameel. I'm going to tell you I've got thousands of evidences, or 1,000 at least, to affirm Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Ibn al-Qayyim is not saying 1,000 only, he's saying even 2,000. He said, ya qawmana wallahi inna li qawlina alfan tadullu alayhi bal alfani. عقلا ونقلا مع صريح الفطرة الأولى. Even عقليا I can prove Allah is above. Why do you when you يعني, why do you when you make dua do you do this? Yeah. وذوق حلاوة القرآن. مع ذلك they still negate those characteristics from Allah. The truth of the matter is the مؤولة who do تأويل, they open the door of بابو الانسلاق من الشريعة. That's where you see today the people, because it's subjective how you look at the Quran. They've opened that. It's all open for interpretations. To people to walk out, atheists, agnostics, يعني, the other people. Also, I've said to one Ash'ari, that brother Allah guided him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. I said to him, I'm going to ask you a question. لماذا يجوز التأويل نصوص صفاتي? Why is it allowed for you to do تأويل of the نصوص of Allah's characteristics and attributes? ولا يجوز تأويل نصوص المعاد. Why can't we do the ta'wil of Jannah and Nar and those characters? And the Batiniyah believe that. They believe those things are not, yani they believe these all are mystical. So why have you chosen to say only the characteristics of attributes of Allah are mutashabih?
And even only some of them. Well, no.
Seven restricted. Yeah. Why do you open and say every single thing in the Quran is mutashabih, even the Jannah and the Nar? And it's funny because there's a guy out there who believes that the Jannah and Nara are all mythical. Also, what it leads to is you add ila isa'at al-dhanni billah. The person starts thinking bad of Allah. Allah is, every time he's saying wallahu alimun, wallahu bi kulli shay'in alimun, wallahu bi kulli, yani Allah is talking about he has wisdom. Allah is saying he's above his throne. And then all of that, he's speaking hypothetical. He's speaking metaphorical. So, yani the biggest ayah in the Quran, ayatul kursi, Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul al-qayyum, shahid, a'zamu ayatin fi kitabillah, is mutashabih. Imagine that someone told you that. Imagine I spoke 80% of what I'm saying to you, all of it is figurative speech. And you just looked at me and said, what is he, on earth is he talking about? You'd say, is this guy majnoon? That's what you say. And also, you're going to say that the Prophet ﷺ, when he was sent for a mission to clarify the Qur'an, he left us and he didn't clarify it to us. Because you're saying the names and attributes of Allah are not about his parent. Mm. So, and also this book, we should start doubting it. Yani, it's shocking. Even one time, I don't want to confuse the people, but I think I'll try to narrow it down. I said, why do you say Allah's characteristics? Why do you open the majaz for it? Because this is the majaz in the Quran.
Majaz means metaphorical.
Metaphorical, not that, it's figurative speech. I said, what's the evidence there's metaphor in the Quran? He said, jidara yuridu an yanqadda. A wall that wants. Sah?
Yeah.
I said, wallahi, that's scary, because you're saying Allah wanted to praise himself in the Quran, but he used characteristics that have tashbih. Allah, instead of praising himself, he subhanahu wa ta'ala belittled himself by giving himself, like, ya iblis ma mana'aka an tasjuda lima khalaqtu bi yadayya. And it's a mawdi' where Allah is praising himself. Why did you not prostrate to someone I created with my hands? You're saying at that moment, Allah was trying to praise himself, but he, you see my point?
Yeah.
He said characteristics that shows weakness. Yad la yaliqu billahi, it's not befitting for Allah, we can't affirm it. You see my point? So,
you know, you open the door to majaz in the Quran. There's another ayah, was'al al-qariya, ask the village or ask the town.
Yeah.
You know, what is the response to these people who say that you say everything in the Quran should be taken as apparent, as a default?
By the way, there are
things that are clearly...
It's funny because in the smallest book they have al-waraqat written by their Sheikh Abu Ali al-Juini. He mentions that the asal is al-zahir, the haqiqah is the asal. And the only time we go to the majaz is when there's a qarina. Well, that's what we're saying. I'm saying there is majaz in the Quran, like the majaz needs a dalil.
Yeah.
If there's a dalil, nabas. Like in Allah's names and attributes, they don't have
majaz.
They're zahir, they're upon the parent. If you go ta'wil, because I'm telling you, Allah will not, you say to me that the Quran, the zahir is not what is intended, and we're reading the Quran, and never did the Prophet ever explain it. You're saying, yani, to the, about the Prophet, yani, ta'khirul bayani fi haqqi rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You're saying that the Prophet ﷺ delayed explaining, or he never even mentioned it. Clarify for the people. The Sahabas were coming. Bedouins were coming. They were not all ulama. Bedouin Sahabas were coming, ridwanullah alayhim ajma'in. And they were sitting in front of him. And he wasn't ever saying to them, adhaharu ghayru murad. And you're saying the Quran is misguiding the people. And Allah said about the Quran, ma anzalna alayka al-Quran litashqa. We did not say the Quran to misguide you. Allah also says, قُلْ إِنْ ضَلَلْتُ فَإِنَّمَا أَضِلُّ عَلَى نَفْسِي وَإِنْ اهْتَدَيْتُ فَبِمَا يُوحِي إِلَيَّ رَبِّي إِنَّهُ سَمِيعٌ قَرِيبٌ. Also, why did Allah tell us to ponder on the Quran if the meaning is not understood? Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala said, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا أَفَلَمْ يَدَّبَّرُوا الْقَوْلَ كِتَابٌ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ. And Allah is telling us to ponder on the Quran, and the overwhelming majority of verses in the Quran have the characteristics and attributes of Allah. And it makes no sense where these people are getting all of this from.
Okay. I was going to give you a summary, but I feel like you just had it. I have to go through two more questions. So we just spent with last episode and this episode, maybe a collection of four, just over 4 hours talking about the beliefs of the Ash'ara. Many people would ask, are these people still in existence today? Like, are there still Ash'aris giving da'wah? Are there still Ash'aris out and about? Like, I just feel like there's some, you know, they must have heard, someone who might have heard you speak for the last 3-4 hours and just thought these beliefs are so crazy and so out there that they actually exist in the 21st century still.
I believe a lot of the young brothers, young innocent brothers, don't believe this stuff, that which I mentioned about the Sha'ira, because they have no knowledge.
Yeah.
Hence why I kept saying, don't attribute yourself to this group. This is the type of belief they have. Get away from it. Get away from this belief. Don't ever, ever let anyone say to you, Ash'ari, from this, now that you learn that this is what they really believe, don't attribute yourself to it. But without a shadow of a doubt, there are people who believed in it, or who still believe in it. There are many people who believe and fight for these issues. Don't go long, far away. Muhammad Sa'id Ramadan Bouti, he believed it. And this was, he wrote in his works. And there's another one right now, his name is Sa'id Foda. And other people like that who are present, like even Azhar, what they teach, and all of these people, they teach these stuff. It's taught. It's not like it's hidden. They teach it. They print these works very often. It comes out. There are people who fight for it. Many of whom, alhamdulillah, were refuted and debunked, like Hassan al-Saqqaf. He was refuted by Sheikh al-Albani, Abdul Fattah Abu Ghudda, Muhammad Zahid al-Kawthari, Mahmoud Ramadan Bouti, Al-Bouti's, all of these people. Sheikh Nasr, when he was alive, he took on a lot of them. Abdul Fattah Abu Ghudda and Abu Albani used to go back and forth with each other. He had Ash'ariyya in him. He lived in Saudi Arabia, by the way. Sheikh Ibn Baz used to advise him and tell him to leave off these things. He wouldn't listen. He got refuted ample times. Also, Muhammad Zahid al-Kawthari al-Halik, who was a teacher of Fattah Ghudda, and got affected by him. Abdulrahman Yahya al-Muallimi took time out for him and refuted him, who really, حقيقةً, is a misguided individual. He insulted 300 righteous people, from Anas ibn Malik, from Imam Malik, al-Imam al-Shafi'i. He slandered these imams in Islam.
Just so he could stick to his belief.
A very fanatic individual, very fanatic. Even al-Ghumari even refuted him at the end, like, well, where are you getting all this from? And now today we have a group of people. Now there's a little movement that's come out, which is they don't call themselves Ash'aris. No, they don't. They're not going to say I'm a Sha'ira, but they are sympathizers of the Sha'ira.
Yeah.
And they will justify the way of the Sha'ira. And they will they call themselves Athari. They give themselves those names, like Abu Hatim al-Auni, and a movement that he has, Abdillah al-Arfaj. People like that, they kind of water down. Alhamdulillah, some mashayikh and some talabatul ilm have refuted them. There's a nice refutation of Sheikh Abdulrahman Abdullah Haqq al-Turkumani, Sheikh Abdul Haqq al-Turkumani on Hatim al-Auni. Nice responses have been given regarding him. Mufum al-Ibadah, what does it mean? Allah's names and attributes. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us that there's always going to be لا تزالوا طائفة من أمتي ظاهرين على الحق. There's always going to be a group of people who are apparent. And also, there's always going to be a group of people defend his religion from the distortion and the mockering and the playing around of people with this deen.
And obviously you mentioned the Arab names in the English speaking world. Without mentioning names, this belief also is prevalent, it's there, it exists.
Yeah, it's there. When you sit with a lot of the learned ones, I've sat with quite a few of those learned ones.
Yeah,
they believe these things. When you tell them, is this what you actually believe? They'll say yes.
And even the brothers giving da'wah using the logical, intellectual, or logical arguments.
Yeah.
This is a path to this. This is where it ends.
Yeah, anyone who really sits down and reads the works of the late Asha'ira, the Asha'ira to Mutakhirin, the late ones, realize that crazy stuff they believe, crazy stuff they affirm. You have to understand, Fakhruddin al-Razi, Ibn Dhahabi mentioned, rahimahullah, what I said about him. And even Ibn Hajar saying, أَوْصَى بِوَصِيَّةِ دُلَّ عَلَىٰ أَنَّهُ حَسَنَ اعْتِقَادَهُ. Al-Dhahabi saying, وَقَدْ بَدَتْ مِنْهُ فِي تَوَالِيفِ بَلَايَا وَعَظَائِمٌ وَسِحْرٌ وَانْحِرَافَاتٌ عَلِي السُنَّةِ وَاللَّهُ يَعْفُ عَنْهُ فَإِنَّهُ تُوفِي عَلَىٰ طَرِيقَةٍ حَمِيدَةٍ وَاللَّهُ يَتَوَلَّى السَّرَائِرَ. And this man, in his works, there's balaya, وَعَظَائِمٌ, great big issues, severe problematic, وَسِحْرٌ وَانْحِرَافٌ عَلِي السُنَّةِ, and magic, and also deviation from the sunnah. Then he said, Wallahu ya'fu anhu. May Allah forgive him. May Allah forgive him.
Okay, final question I have for you. I want to take it back to the hadith you mentioned right at the start of this podcast, Hadith al-Iftiraq, about the 73 sects and 72 of them going into the fire. The Asha'ala, obviously, you believe are from those 72. Does that mean that you're making takfir of them? Does that mean that they are disbelievers because they go into the hellfire?
No, not at all. You see, the 72 groups are min ummati Muhammad. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, سَتَفْتَرِقُ أُمَّتِي, he means أُمَّةُ الْإِجَابَةِ.
So that automatically means they are Muslims.
They're Muslims. They're not going to stay in hellfire forever.
So how do you understand that they go to hellfire for a period of time, and then
just like the major sins.
Okay.
And when the hadith, when you read that, anyone who does this is going to go to the hellfire from the major sins. It's like the kabair. And I've explained it. That's not the only view. There's actually another view out there. Ahlus Sunnah believe with the explanation. But we have a course on it in the Essentials where we speak about Firaq wal Iftiraq, where we spoke about groups, and we gave an introduction and an overview, and we explained this hadith in great details. Great details. And the whole course is really about this.
Okay.
So there's that one interpretation is that they are kulluha fi nari illa wahida, is they are like the kabair.
Okay, yeah. So they end up in the hellfire, but they're going to eventually leave the hellfire. The major sins,
like the major sins.
They go to hellfire for a period of time.
But this is, another group of people came, they said, how is that possible when innovation is greater than...
Mm-hmm.
So there's another discussion as well.
Okay, fine. Okay, I'm done with my questions. Do you want to give it a very quick summary, or do you feel comfortable with what you've said so far?
I hope Allah Ta'ala doesn't, hold me account to the mistakes I've done and the shortcomings that have come from me. But I do just want to say one thing to the Muslims is that, Ya akhi, this is your religion. Yani, don't let a love you have for a particular imam or a group of people that you were raised and you were with. And this is deen, it's not a football team that you champion from one group and then you look at that. Just remember, this is your deen, and you're going to be brought yawm al-qiyamati furada. You're going to be brought yawm al-qiyamah by yourself. And you're going to be the one slave, and you're going to be questioned by yourself, and you're going to be interrogated by yourself. So you just remember, look at this argument, sift through it, and ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to guide you that which is the best. And if the early people of this ideology of the Ash'ariyya felt like they regretted what they did, لَقَطُفْتُ فِي تِلْكَ الْمَعَاهِدِ كُلِّهَا وَسَيَّرْتُ طَرَفِي بَيْنَ تِلْكَ الْمَعَالِمِ فَلَمْ أَرَ إِلَّا وَاضِعًا كَفَّ حَيْرَةٍ عَلَى ذَقْنٍ أَوْ قَارِعًا سِنَّ نَادِمِ. This is what they're saying. I traveled the land, he's saying. لَقَطُفْتُ فِي تِلْكَ الْمَعَاهِدِ كُلِّهَا. I traveled all around these lands. وَسَيَّرْتُ طَرَفِي بَيْنَ تِلْكَ الْمَعَالِمِ. And I looked at all of these schools and all of these ideology and methodology. I looked at all, he's saying. فَلَمْ أَرَى. I never saw, he said. إِلَّا وَاضِعًا كَفَّ حَيْرَةٍ. I only saw a person who placed his hand under his chin out of confusion. عَلَى ذَقْنٍ أَوْ قَارِعٍ سِنَّ نَادِمٍ. On another person who regretted what he did in his life. 30 years you've been قِيلَ وَقَالْ. And he said, and what, Fakhruddin said at the end, وَلَمْ نَسْتَفِيدْ مِنْ بَحْثِ طُولِ عُمْرِنَا سِوَا أَنْ جَمَعْنَا قِيلَ وَقَالُ. All he compiled, and at the end, he said, I'm going to affirm Ar-Rahman wa Halal Arshi Istawa. Wallah, wallah. He said, I'm going to affirm all of these things. So, by the way, these issues are not trivial issues. It's why you were created. Allah created you to know these issues. Allahu alladhi khalaqa sab'a samawati wa min al-ardi mithlahunna. Yatanazzalu al-amru baynahunna. Lita'alamu, so you can know. Anna Allah ala kulli shay'in qadir. That Allah has ability of everything. Wa anna Allah qad ahata bi kulli shay'in ilma. Allah also ja'ala al-ka'bata al-bayt al-harama. Qiyaman lil-nasi wa shahra al-harama. Wal-hadiya wal-qala'ida. ذلك لتعلموا أن الله يعلم ما في السماوات وما في الأرض وأن الله بكل شيء عليم. Also, by just learning Allah's names and attributes and understanding it, what's going to happen? You're going to go to Jannah because of it. The Hadith Bukhari Muslim narrated من حديث أبي هريرة, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, إن لله 99 أسماء 100 إلا واحدا من أحصاها دخل الجنة. Allah has 99 names. Anyone who masters them, studies them, it's not just the wording, also the meaning, he will enter Jannah. Also, it's a means for you to, inshallah ta'ala, to be able to implement the hadith. مَنْ رَأَى مِنْكُمْ مُنْكَرًا فَلِيُغَيِّرْهُ بِيَدِهِ فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ فَبِلِسَانِهِ فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ فَبِقَلْبِهِ وَذَلِكَ أَضْعَفُ الْإِيمَانِ. To be able to debunk the people who are speaking about Allah Ta'ala's names and attributes in the wrong way, you'll be able to implement the hadith by debunking them, by refuting them, by exposing them. Finally, Allah Ta'ala instructed us categorically, clearly to know Him by His names and attributes. Allah says, وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. Allah also says, وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ فَحَذَرُوا وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ حَلِيمٌ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الْمُتَّقِينَ فَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. All of those verses, Allah is instructing us what? He's saying, وَعْلَمُوا, know. And that's a fi'il amr, right? And a fi'il amr shows what? Wujub. It's obligatory. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has the ability to guide. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. The last and final point I want to mention is that the reason why division came is this issue of ta'wil. A lot of people say, Akhi, you're causing division by bringing these issues up. Ta'wil was where the ummah became divided. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, he mentions in his Nuniyah, he said, هَذَا وَأَصْلُ بَلِيَّةِ الْإِسْلَامِ مِنْ تَأْوِيلِ ذِي الْتَحْرِيفِ وَالْبُطْلَانِ وَهُوَ الَّذِي فَرَّقَ السَّبْعِينَ بَلْ زاد الثلاثا قول ذي البرهان وهو الذي قتل الخليفة جامع القرآن ذي النورين والإحسان وهو الذي قتل الخليفة بعده أعني عليا قاتل الأقران وهو الذي قتل الحسين وأهله فغدوا عليه ممزق اللحمان. يعني 73 groups or the 72 groups only came about because they started to go to ta'wil. Ta'wil is what was used to kill Uthman رضي الله عنه. They interpreted those verses onto him and they killed him. The Khawarij only came about because of ta'wil of the Quran. They applied it on Ali and they killed him. It was ta'wil why Hussein ibn Ali was killed and he was murdered, يعني cold-blooded. وهو الذي قتل الحسين وأهله فغدوا عليه ممزق اللحمان. So we have to understand ta'wil is not something we want. It's a path that we should close. It's wallahi speaking about Allah tabarak wa ta'ala with no knowledge. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُجَادِلُونَ فِي آيَاتِ اللَّهِ بِغَيْرُ سُلْطَانٍ أَتَاهُمْ إِنْ فِي صُدُورِ مِنْ لَا كِبْرُ مَا هُمْ بِبَالِغِهِ فَاسْتَعِذِ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّهُ هُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. So I implement that verse and I seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from any mistakes or shortcomings that I might have come with. سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمَّ بِحَمْدِ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ أَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ.